Majority Report with Sam Seder.
The destiny of America is always safer in the hands of the people than in the conference rooms of any elite.
Sam Seder.
They are unanimous in their hate for me, and I welcome their hatred.
We must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex.
The Majority Report with Sam Seder.
Ever get the feeling you've been cheated?
It is Monday, November 11th, 2019. My name is Sam Seder. This is the five-time award-winning Majority Report. We are broadcasting live steps from the industrially ravaged Gowanus Canal in the heartland of America, downtown Brooklyn, USA. On the program today, financial journalist and author Nicholas Shaxson on the finance curse, how global finance is making us all poorer. Also on the program today, Bolivia in the throes of a U.S.-enabled violent coup, and public impeachment hearings start this week, all day Wednesday. We'll be covering them live. Last week's elections across the country still yielding big left-wing wins. And the famously Islamophobic Congressman Peter King to not seek re-election this year. Sad, sad sounds. Meanwhile, speaking of sad, Pete Buttigieg creeping up in Iowa in the wake of the biggest campaign rally in 2019 when AOC came to town. Meanwhile, what is John Bolton's game? He wants to testify, but he wants to be made to testify. And Democrats softly and silently kill an abused NSA spying program. And the Democrats take a key step to finally ratifying the ERA. Lastly, the Supreme Court to hear DACA arguments, all this and more. Oh, and Lula is out of prison. I guess that happened over the weekend. I thought that was...
It happened on Friday, and he's already done two major rallies.
All this and more on today's program. I feel like that happened like a week ago.
We did that. We were talking about live on air on Saturday. He did a major rally at the Metal Workers Union, and Steve Bannon said he's the chief of the globalists.
There you go. Chief globalist. Ladies and gentlemen, happy Veterans Day. If you are a veteran, if you have someone in your family who's a veteran, offer our thanks and in some respects, our apologies that our civilian leadership couldn't do a better job of keeping you from being in a conflict if you were, in fact, in a conflict. Just one quick note on that regard. There was a story in the Washington Post. I guess it was an op-ed by the executive director of the Connecticut Veterans Legal Center. And this guy, Liam Brennan, is talking about the more than 500,000 former service members who received an other than honorable discharge. And as such, they are ineligible for VA services. According to the GAO, in 2017, 62% of the 92,000 service members discharged for misconduct between 2011 and 2015 were diagnosed with PTSD. And the thing about the Veterans Administration, their system of hospitals, and yes, there have been in times some problems, but broadly speaking, not only is it sort of an amazing government agency in terms of, and huge in terms of what it runs and the sophistication of what it runs, in terms of the medical care, it has medical care that you cannot get anywhere else because in civilian medical care. You just don't come across the same type of injuries, whether they are mental or emotional or physical, that you do amongst the military population. And so they're providing a specific, a unique service. But at the very least, if we were to have a Medicare for all type of system, none of this would be nearly as relevant in terms of so many of our vets being homeless or having substance abuse program problems, et cetera. So we can celebrate our vets by actually improving the situation for tens of millions of other people in this country as well. But I don't know that we'll do that, but we hope springs eternal. So just wanted to mention that on Veterans Day. All right, let's move along. This was a fun clip. You know, there's been a renewed vigor by billionaires who seem to be freaking out at the prospect of either Bernie or Warren winning. And they've really spent their targeted their ire over the past week or two on Warren. I suspect simply because they are of the belief that Bernie is not a significant electoral threat. I think they're going to be mistaken. They're mistaken in that assessment, and I suspect we will hear them talk about Bernie later. But they, right for the time being, have been going after Warren, and it's been nice because now they're getting a little bit more exposed. They're engaging in this fight, and that is good because they can't win the rhetorical argument. They're going to win the other part, or very likely.
The stuff about power.
Exactly. Because of the billions and billions of dollars they have. But for every Michael Bloomberg that throws his hat into the race, there's another billionaire somewhere just trying to lay low, or one who's just trying to seem like, well, I'm one of the good guys. Like Jamie Dimon. When we heard during the financial crisis, it was Chase was supposedly the good bank.
Hashtag not all billionaires.
Exactly.
That was even worse. That was literally not all banks.
Right.
Like as an institution.
Now, I don't know if Jamie Dimon is specifically a billionaire, but
I think so.
He's extremely wealthy. 100 millionaire, several times over at the very least. And here is Leslie
he's
Stahl.
He's a billionaire.
He is a billionaire. Ah, there you go. Here's Leslie Stahl asking, and they really don't like it when you're not stroking them. And when you sit down with 60 Minutes, like even then, like, how dare you? Here is Leslie Stahl asking a fairly benign question.
Executive pay. Last year, you were paid $31 million. Too high?
The board sets mine. I have nothing to do with it.
Well, you could return some
of it. Now, this is amazing. This guy, it's like won the lottery. I have nothing to do with what I get paid. That's fascinating. He's the only guy in America who doesn't just like, bliff, $31 million, $3,500, whatever the board says. There you go.
Nothing to do with it.
Oh, pause. You know who points the board? Well, I think it's the CEO who gets to at least nominate some people, right? Somebody's got to appoint people to the board. Suggest, serves up. Is it? Who it is? I don't know.
I think I'm looking at what Jamie Dimon's titles are to see if his relationship to it.
Here we go. Oh, I'm sure.
That's mine. I have nothing to do with it.
Well, you could return some of it.
I could. Is that going to solve any of those problems?
I don't know.
Is it going to solve any of those problems?
No, but you could set an example, say, I'm not going to take all that money.
Okay.
I don't need it.
I could. I'm going to leave it to the board to set my comp. Not you, not the press.
You've answered
my board,
every one of my questions,
my
but this one you're fobbing off.
Yeah, the board has to do it.
Well, let me ask it in a general way. Should executive pay in this country be curbed?
What does that mean?
Cut back. Should there be a way to say, we're not going to have...
I mean, what could he possibly have been mistaken? Like, I'm very confused. Like, curbed?
Curb your dog?
You mean like, what, picked up off the ground? I don't understand.
Hold on.
And this is, you know, he's all like, I'm not going to answer this specific question about me. Give me a general question. A general question? Oh, I don't understand what you're talking about.
Should executive pay in this country be curbed?
What does that mean?
Cut back. Should there be a way to say, we're not going to have such a spread between our workers and the guy at the top?
You know, when you say something like that, you got to say, how are you going to do it? What does it make sense? I think you use the tax system to do that. I would not have cut the tax on the rich. I would have expended your earned income tax credit instead, which is like a negative income tax for lower paid people. We probably should change the minimum wages. I don't think it's been changed for like 10 or 15 years. There are solutions to these problems. The problems are real. It does not mean free enterprise.
Okay, well, now I'll tell you what's encouraging is that you have Jamie Dimon publicly promoting these things. Now, the reason he's doing that is because he wants to maintain all of his money, his obscene amount of wealth that has come, at least in part, not totally, but from the immiseration of other people. That's just the bottom line. In fact, our next guest is going to be talking about that over-financialization. But it is also unstable. And that's why I think he knows, like, well, can't we shore things up? But if you were reminded of something of Jamie Dimon's appearance on 60 Minutes, I think I know what it is. It was this moment from the fake 60 Minutes on Saturday Night Live over 30 years ago.
Pardon me for saying this, but you seem defensive.
I'm not being defensive. You're the one who's being defensive. Why is it always the other person who's being defensive?
Life imitates
that
art.
Martin Short line. That's so clever. Why is it always the other person who's being defensive?
Oh, folks, my transformation is complete. Every single pair of underwear I own is now an Everlane pair of underwear. There you go. Thank you very much. Hey, now, you know what? I mean, it is a big deal because when you get to be my age, advanced in years, breaking your habits are not easy to do. It has to be something absolutely special, and I'm super psyched about it.
I'm sorry. And I like to give you a hard time, and deservedly so, but are you really officially advanced in years?
I am advanced in years,
wow.
Of course.
All right. There I don't know why I want to say that, but okay.
Not to mention, that's just one of the upshots about Everlane. Everlane makes premium essentials using the finest materials without traditional markups. Would you buy a t-shirt for $50 if you knew it only cost $7 to make? Well, I wouldn't. And Everlane wants you to know what you're paying for and why. So they are radically transparent about their real costs in every step of their process, from the materials they use to the ethical factories they work on. Not to mention the essentials, like their cotton crew t-shirt, are exactly what they should be. Versatile, simple, stylish, and made from quality materials. Which reminds me, Brendan told me the best hoodie he has is from Everlane. Is that it right there? I have that one. I also need one that's zipped, though.
He does look cozy.
Everlane's clothes look better, they cost less, and they last longer. They have 100% grade A cashmere. They have a cashmere hoodie. Maybe you want to get on that. They have quality cotton basics, like I say. Amazing underwear. They have premium Japanese denim made at the world's cleanest denim factory. They have Italian made leather shoes, and they have perfectly fit Oxford shirts. Right now, you can check out our personalized collection at everlane.com/majority. Plus, get free shipping on your first order. Go to everlane.com/majority. Everlane.com/majority. Check it out, folks. It's very rare that I find clothes stores that I wholeheartedly embrace, and it's happened for me with Everlane. On the other end of the spectrum, however, over 100 million people have had their personal information stolen in a major data breach. See, it feels like this happens every day, and then you don't find out about it until 6 months later. Social security numbers, contact details, credit scores, more, all taken from Capital One customers. These kinds of attack, like I say, are getting more and more frequent. It's not just Capital One. Equifax, the company that's supposed to maintain your credit rating. Facebook, eBay, Uber, PlayStation, Yahoo, they've all leaked passwords, credit cards, and bank numbers belonging to billions of users. That's why you need ExpressVPN. You can't control how big corporations mishandle your data, but you can protect yourself. ExpressVPN is an app for your computer and phone that encrypts and secures your data. If you care about your privacy and safety, you shouldn't go online without ExpressVPN. ExpressVPN connects with just one click, so it's super easy. It's lightning fast, and it costs less than $7 a month. ExpressVPN is rated the number one VPN provider by TechRadar, CNET, The Verge, countless others. Go to expressvpn.com/majority right now to arm yourself with an extra 3 months of ExpressVPN for free. Support the show. Protect yourself. ExpressVPN.com/majority for an extra 3 months free. And lastly, nobody's got any time left. Nobody, I mean, I'm not saying we're all going to die, although that's possible. But
it's an interesting way to begin an ad.
Well, look, whether it's just like you don't have the time of the week that you need, or you just don't have much time left for all of us, you want to go out well-versed and knowledgeable. So if you feel like you can't find the time to read all the books on your list, Blinkist is an app that compiles the key takeaways from thousands of nonfiction books. Everything you need to know condensed down to 15 minutes. You can read it. You can listen to it. All on the app. Blinkist is really unique. It works on your phone, works on your tablet, works on your web browser. Find everything from health and self-help titles to history and business books included in Blinkist library. You know that I've talked about like the perfect example of this, with all due respect to Tim Ferriss, I was not going to read the entire 4-hour work week, or frankly, what was it, the 4-hour diet or something like that?
I only know the work week.
He does a whole series of them, and I wasn't going to read them, but I was interested in them because anything I can do to make more time for myself, those are the type of books in the 4-hour
remember
work
what
week,
you said though? What? You said, less time, but more coconut.
That's right.
That was how you got on a coconut kick.
That's when
after
I did
reading
the,
Ferriss.
It's the
not work less, but lots more.
What
coconut.
Do you call it? The
bulletproof. Yes,
thing.
I remember that.
But that is a perfect example. You get the key takeaways. 15 minutes. Boom, you're done. The Power of Habits by Charles Duhigg. Same thing. I'm not going to read the whole book, but I want the key takeaways. With Blinkist, you get unlimited access to read or listen to a massive library of condensed nonfiction books. So instead, I'll play chess with Saul for an extra 15 minutes or 20 minutes. So I'm not spending it reading a book that, you know, I just need the takeaways. I don't need to hear the prose. It's all the books you want for one low price. Right now, for a limited time, Blinkist has a special offer for our listeners. Go to Blinkist.com/majority. Try it for free for 7 days and then save 25% off your new subscription. That's Blinkist, Blinkist.com/majority to start your free 7-day trial and save 25% off. Of course, if you go to our podcast subscription or our YouTube subscription, you will find that link there. All right, going to take a quick break. When we come back, we'll be talking to Nicholas Shaxson, author of the finance course, How Global Finance is Making Us All Poorer. Be right back. We are back. Sam Seder on the Majority Report on the phone. It is a pleasure to welcome to the program financial journalist and author of The Finance Curse, How Global Finance is Making Us All Poorer, Nicholas Shaxson. Welcome to the program.
Thanks. Pleasure to talk to you.
And you did two versions of this book. One is the one is a British version. One is a U.S. version. The story is largely the same. Some of the examples are a little bit different. We'll focus on the American ones so that people know what you know, can have a little bit more sense of, like, I guess, of familiarity with these things. But the broader story is this move to financialize essentially our economy. Will you just walk us through, basically, I guess, from Bretton Woods, which you cite as sort of the, I guess, the sort of the standard from where we started, and then over time we fell.
Yes, I mean, historically there has been. There have been periods of kind of conflict between the financial sector and what you might call the mainstream economy, the rest of the economy. The Bretton Woods period after the Second World War was a period when countries came together and there was a huge political willingness to do something about the financial sector, which had previously, you know, the Great Depression was still in people's minds, which was very substantially caused by financial deregulation. They decided to put in place an international cooperative architecture that would effectively crunch the financial sector in many countries right down, restrict it with heavy regulations, break up big banks, and put in a lot of you know, high tax rates, and, you know, very, very progressive policies. And the financial, you know, this was called an era of financial repression, when the financial sector was really very heavily restricted, and they were furious about it. But that was a period of the highest economic growth in world history, when all these very progressive policies were in place. Before or since, there has never been a period of sustained economic growth around the world in different countries, the United States and elsewhere, as that period when finance was very heavily suppressed. Not only that, but when the financial sector was suppressed, you had a very growth was very broad based. You know, inequality was falling. There was just, you know, this is the era of the American dream, and there's all sorts of different terms in different countries to talk about this period. Then we had the 1970s, when there was you know, sort of a crisis era when there was a lot of finance moving increasingly quickly around the globe. It was able to escape the constraints of the Bretton Woods system, and you started getting ideological changes when there was deregulation, financial deregulation, and people said, look, guys, this isn't working. We're going to have to loosen financing. We want more credit in our economies. And so they loosened regulations, and the financial sector from that era really began growing very substantially until the global financial crisis. And that period was an era of falling growth and also rising inequality. And this kind of speaks to one of the central themes of my book, which is that, as I put it crudely, too much finance can make you poor. It's kind of a paradox. You know, we all need a financial sector, but once it grows beyond a certain size and beyond its useful roles, it starts to turn nasty. It starts to have harmful and predatory effects in your economy. And so that's kind of the essence of the finance curse thesis.
Okay, and so I mean, just so that people know, Bretton Woods obviously was a meeting that took place in New Hampshire. There was I don't know, something near 50 allied nations there. The Soviets attended at the time, but declined to ratify the final agreements. What I mean, and maybe we can circle back to get a sense of, like, what, you know, what was happening in parallel as that system began to sort of cave. I mean, at the time, I know the Soviets had said that the institutions they had created were essentially tools of Wall Street, and maybe they were somewhat dormant on some level for a while, but. Let's, while we're here, When we say finance, will you just give a more explicit definition for folks that so that people can really wrap their minds on this? Because when we, you know, we hear quite a bit the financialization of the economy, I'm not sure that people fully understand what that means.
Yeah, it's a very good question. I mean, I take finance, I look at finance in a very broad form, and I see it kind of like the rings of an onion. So right at the center, you have the, you know, the traditional banks and particularly the big banks. And then outside of that, you have more esoteric institutions, investment funds, and, you know, shadow banking institutions, things that are outside the normal banking regulation, some of them very kind of esoteric. You know, we're talking trillions of dollars here. So that's the sort of central part of the financial system. But the other part is what you call, what you've referred to as financialization. And what that is the kind of penetration of finance, of financial tools, of financial institutions, financial techniques into other parts of the economy, into agriculture, into manufacturing, into big technology, into tourism, whatever. Every other sector of the economy has been subject to what you might call financialization. I've recently been in Iowa, and I have a chapter on agriculture in yes. Iowa in my book. And you see a whole period of time, again, sort of starting in the 70s with all sorts of things happening. But you see a real change in, I mean, I looked at the hog farming sector, and there's been a tremendous transformation in hogs and in poultry, where you used to have large numbers of independent family farms and also large numbers of meat lockers and other kind of, you know, market institutions that allowed a sort of independent competitive market to thrive. And over time, you saw the arrival of money, particularly from, you know, Wall Street, Chicago, you know, big money center banking started to take over and started to displace the sort of local relationship banking that was the sort of heart and soul of this system. And what you saw then was a period, I mean, there's lots of reasons for why some of the agricultural, the small communities in Iowa and other parts of the Midwest have kind of shrunk. And, you know, if you go to a lot of these small towns, you know, once thriving businesses have shuttered up. I mean, I was walking down the high street of Williams, Iowa yesterday and looking at all the shops I was being shown, all the shops that used to be open, and there's almost nothing left now. And there are various reasons for this. I mean, mechanization and, you know, the rise of, you know, tractors and seed technology and things like that have displaced a certain number of workers. But one of the things, and that's kind of seen as progress and unavoidable and, you know, just the way things have gone. But I think one of the things that people are missing is that there's also been this financialization element going on. So what you had is a the change from a system where money used to kind of stay much more in the local economy. When you had a system of lots of independent farmers, they would be buying from the local seed merchant, from the local parts supplier. They would be going to the local doctor and the local vet. But what you've had happening since then is these small independent farmers have been squeezed out by big agricultural firms, very big agricultural firms, with a lot of money from the big money centers financing this change. And what you've seen is this, these kind of local circulatory mechanisms where money was sort of staying in the local economy, these have sort of been unrolled and turn more into more of a conveyor belt. So the wealth is that used to be circulating locally is now kind of being shipped out, shipped outwards to, you know, the big money centers, to state capitals, but also internationally. It's going offshore. It's going, you know, two of the biggest firms are JBS and Smithfield, which are respectively Brazilian and Chinese. So a lot of this money, this wealth, you know, while you've had mechanization and technology massively increasing yields, you know, the actual wealth that's been created and coming out of the ground, you have paradoxically been seeing a kind of impoverishment of many of these communities. And there's, you know, it's the same paradox, you know, more money coming into the system, but many of these communities seem to be poorer than they were. And this, for me, is very significantly a story of financialization. And I think one of the, you know, one of the hopeful messages of this book and one of the hopeful messages of this particular story of hog farming is that even though, you know, the rise in technology and the improvement of yields and all that is progress, and it's, you know, some jobs have been lost, but that's, there is an inevitability about this. This financial side of things, that what I call the finance curse, the financialization of the agricultural economy is reversible. And you can do that, and you can break up these big agricultural firms and you know, return competition to these sectors, and you can reduce the use of tax havens and all these kind of tricks and techniques that are being used to extract wealth and create a new kind of economy.
Well, I want to circle back on some of those solutions and how we roll this back. But can you be more specific in terms of the way that this money is extracted from Iowa? So, for instance, or we can use you talk about a New Jersey newspaper, which has this extraction is, you know, and I think maybe that's easier for people to see because We have examples of it almost every day, whether it's, you know, sort of local newspapers, or we see it in the context of online journalism, where wealth is being extracted and the localities are being impoverished by this. I mean, just so that people can see this dynamic, because it's one thing to say like, okay, well, the money just somehow, you know, is spent outside of the community, but there's more that's going on here, right? Like these are firms, and maybe it's the entree into this is through the private equity firms. The money is being extracted, and almost the business is almost secondary to extracting all the value out of it.
Yeah, that's exactly right. I think private equity is a very good way to illustrate what's going on here. Private equity firms, their basic business model is to go in and buy up companies, again, across the economy, from agriculture or newspapers or manufacturing or whatever, and to take those companies and then to try and make a profit for their investors. So the private equity you know, the moguls, the titans, they will get co-investors, your pension funds, whatever, will come in alongside them. They'll have a huge pot of money and they'll invest, they'll buy up companies. Usually these are perfectly healthy company, productive companies with good, strong cash flows. That's what they're generally most interested in. And they buy these companies up. And then what they do is they take those cash flows and they do kind of financial engineering. And the way they do this is they identify all the stakeholders of that company once they've got it, once they've got control of it. And they say, okay, let's look. Okay, this one stakeholder is the workers. So let's now reduce their benefits. Let's now crush the unions and let's now get some more money out of workers. So they will do that. And in the case of the newspaper I was talking to, there was the Trentonian, there had been a huge reduction in staffing levels, and they had been, you know, working conditions were much worse than they used to be. So there was money kind of, you know, there's money kind of taken out of workers, and new cash flows are generated for them. Then they will go after maybe the pension fund, and they'll say, right, there's the terms of the pension fund are too generous. Let's, you know, take some money out of that. They might go after the company suppliers and put more onerous terms on them or pay them late or whatever. Then maybe they might think, okay, we're in a niche here and we want to monopolize this market niche. So let's buy up a load of companies that are doing the same sort of stuff. And then we kind of control all or most of them. Once we've got that, we've got market power, and then we can, you know, we can get more money. We can raise our prices or we can reduce wages to workers even further. And we can get even more money from this stakeholder group. And so they do this kind of, look at all the different stakeholders, and they just extract more money. They also will tend to make the company that they've bought take on a huge amount of debt. And this is important, that the actual owners, the moguls, the titans, are not the ones who are on the hook for this debt. They hang the debt on the shoulders of the company that they've bought. So now you've got a much more indebted company, and the proceeds of that borrowing that company has been made, they now funnel it up in special dividends to the actual owners of the company. So the owners of the companies get very rich indeed. In many cases, whether or not the underlying company that they bought actually succeeds. So you have a hugely indebted company that may fail, it may go bankrupt, but they have already paid this special dividend, this huge special dividend to the owners, and the owners may have already made all their money back and then some. by financially engineering these cash flows, taking more money out of all the stakeholders, and paying themselves these huge special dividends. So you end up with a fragilized economy, but some very rich people indeed. And, you know, some of the, you know, people look at these billionaires and they say, well, this is a sign of economic success. But in many times, in many cases, in terms of this kind of financialization, it is the flip side of impoverishment, impoverishment elsewhere. It is kind of the flip side of economic failure.
Toys R Us is a great example of that type of leverage buyout, and then larding up the company with debt, everybody walking away, and people losing their jobs and their pensions and whatever it was. But we see this all over the place. So with this private equity model, essentially, where it comes in, extracts all the wealth, does not care about the community or really the future of the business. I mean, at one point, right? It's just like it's many wealth. We see this in hospitals quite a bit around the country, in this country as well, don't we?
Yeah, absolutely. I think the healthcare sector is, there's a huge amount of extraction going on there. And I think a lot of that is local monopolization. I think, yep. You know, private equity firms and others, you know, it's not just private equity firms, but private equity has kind of, in many cases, spearheaded and designed these financial techniques that are then copied by all sorts of other players. And they will go into the healthcare sector and they will look at a local market. You know, they may not have a national monopoly on something, but they may have a local monopoly on provision of healthcare services. And then once they've got a lock on that market, they have market power and they can just jack up the prices. And alongside that, they will be using all sorts of tax haven strategies and all sorts of other financial techniques, using debt and, you know, very complicated financial engineering to juice the returns to the owners of those companies.
Let's talk about tax havens and tax avoidance. I think when most of us here think about that, we think about the Grand Cayman Islands. Or some such place, but you also talk about South Dakota.
Well, yes, indeed. One of the things, I actually wrote a book about tax havens about 10 years ago called Treasure Islands, where I looked at the whole offshore system. And one of the great revelations for me as I was looking into this was that tax havens are not where we think they are. One of the biggest, and arguably the biggest player in the whole system of offshore tax havens is the United Kingdom, Britain, my country. Where you have the City of London financial center surrounded by a kind of network of satellite tax havens from the Cayman Islands to the British Virgin Islands to Bermuda to Jersey, a whole lot of others. But also there are all sorts of little, the whole offshore system of tax havens is like an ecosystem with lots of different niches and lots of different players all over the place providing different services. So South Dakota was very interesting. If you go to Sioux Falls, there's a kind of main street where there's a few of these basically wealth management companies, and they are offering services to billionaires and very wealthy people to help them escape paying taxes. And they've got all sorts of tricks they use trusts and many other mechanisms to help them escape paying taxes and also escape other rules and regulations that they may not like. And for me, you know, Sioux Falls illustrated one of the, you know, again, one of the great themes of the finance curse, this idea that, you know, the money that all these trillions that you see, these billionaires and all this money that seems to be circulating in these places doesn't seem to actually be trickling down to the ordinary people who work in these places. So if you go to Sioux Falls, you know, the main street where all that money is, there's nothing very impressive there. You know, you'd think with all this billionaire wealth circulating on paper through these places that there would be a lot more kind of trickle down, a lot more wealth generated locally. But in fact, you know, it's just a couple of hundred jobs really that have been created at the expense of much, much larger losses to U.S. taxpayers elsewhere.
What are the circumstances that Sioux Falls becomes, that South Dakota becomes this magnet as opposed to, say, I don't know, New York State or New Jersey?
Well, South Dakota has got a 0% tax rate for certain aspects of the way you structure your financial affairs, and it is also the other thing about South Dakota is that it is a very small state, and this is kind of in parallel to other tax havens. A lot of the most important tax havens in the world, like the Cayman Islands, are very small states. And the main reason for this is that big finance, big global mobile finance, is able to influence the legislatures of these places, able to influence lawmakers much more easily in a very small state, where you can kind of, you know, somewhere like Bermuda with just 50,000 people, but, you know, some of the biggest companies in the world and many billionaires coming there, they can have enormous influence. You know, they come into these little places and often the lawmakers, you know, don't have particular expertise in finance. And you have these accountants and lawyers coming in with incredibly complicated legislation saying, look, you need to approve this and, you know, you'll make a lot of money. And so generally, it's quite easy to influence the legislatures of these places to change the laws, to create, you know, for example, a secrecy law. And, of course, the South Dakota has some very powerful secrecy laws that if you incorporate in that state, you know, you'll be able to cast a veil over your financial affairs. That's another big aspect of it. But I think this idea of what, you know, kind of the political capture of the state of the state is very strong in these small places. It'd be much more difficult in a place like New York because you have all these Democratic constituencies to go up against. Whereas in these small places, you can just get what you want if you're, you know, big finance.
I wish I could take your response and frame it on the wall for every debate I have with so-called libertarian, is really sort of neo-Confederates, as to why bigger actually can be better in that regard. I've tried to make people understand that dynamic of smaller entities can be much more easily bought by much bigger, wealthier entities. It just becomes, you know, sort of cat's play for them.
Yeah, exactly. And there's another thing. There's another aspect of this is that states kind of compete with each other. You know, one state puts in place a very clever secrecy law, and another state will look at that and say, "Hey, we can do something even cleverer and more devious than that." So they put something in, and then the first state or other states join in and put in something even worse. So you kind of get this race to the bottom, this spiral to the bottom of, you know, deeper secrecy and more relaxed regulation and stuff like this. It's going on all the time among U.S. states, but it's also going on internationally between countries.
You also at least allude to the problem of fake news. And when we talk about this regime of financialization that has taken over, where you know, you have holding companies or private equity owning hospitals and nurses' shifts, hours, and how long they have to work is being dictated by people who simply want to extract more wealth out of these hospitals. And so they're developing, you know, procedures, essentially, based upon how much more money they can take out of these hospitals or whatever it is, as an example. But this exists, or they've been able to do this, or they've been aided by the fake news of that you say comes from the economics profession. Do tell.
Yeah, so, you know, there's various flavors of fake news. I mean, there's the stuff we all know about that is just kind of, you know, lies and all that stuff that we see in our airwaves all the time. But when I'm talking, you know, I spend a bit of time talking about the fake news that comes out of the financial sector, which is really, it has so much influence over our cultures, our media, our political system, that you get a kind of consensus happening. And again, I would, you know, take the private equity example again. One of the probably the biggest tool in the private equity toolbox for making money is what I call other people, what's known as other people's money, OPM. And what happens is you get the moguls coming in and they attract other co-investors to, you know, put their money with them, and then they invest them and they take huge fees out of, and the fees depend on how much OPM, how many billions they've got to people to come and co-invest alongside them. So to attract this OPM, this other people's money, you need to basically, you need to get involved in storytelling, telling, you know, why I'm the greatest, why you must invest with us, and why it's important to give me your money. And so much of the financial sector has become about storytelling, about trying to say that we need these things, we'll have more billions. You know, just this simple idea that, you know, all these billionaires are rich, therefore you're going to get rich as well. You know, there's this kind of idea of trickle down. And you know, they do need to tell these stories. So they invest huge amounts of money in think tanks, in universities, in just generally trying to change people's minds about what's important and trying to put a financial view out there. And often you get, you know, when a political event happens, I see it a lot in my own country, and it also happens a lot here. When something happens, you know, the media will call up an analyst, but they won't call up, you know, if you have a plane crash or something, you know, the 737 crash, you know, very often they won't call up an engineer. They'll call up someone from Wall Street or the City of London to analyze this. And very often, you know, these players are kind of the part of the problem. They are the ones who are calling for money to be taken out of these companies to, you know, which results in, you know, a loss of investment. And in the case of, you know, the 737, for example, yep. there's a strong case for saying that you know, safety standards were reduced because so much money had to be paid as dividends to shareholders in Wall Street.
So you get all these. You cite Bill Lozanek, who's been a guest multiple times on this show, who recently wrote a piece about that very issue with the 737 that. The company had the opportunity, I don't know if it was a decade or two ago, to make some structural changes to the planes that were a function of changes in U.S. airports. They decided, rather than to overhaul their planes, they cut some corners, and they figured they could do a software patch, essentially, to deal with this this slight redesign of their plane, and we saw what happened.
Exactly, yes. And Bill Lozanek, as much as anybody, has done fantastic research. And his, you know, his big thing is shareholder value, this idea that what matters is wealth coming out for the owners, you know, for the shareholders. And this is all about extracting wealth. You know, in the book, I make this great contrast between wealth extraction and wealth creation. You know, wealth creation is the stuff we need in our economy. This is, you know, productive things being done, creating new widgets and services and all sorts. But then the extractors come along and they start sucking the wealth out of you know, out of businesses and so on. And this has not only economic dimensions, it not only reduce, you know, does things like reduce overall economic growth and increase inequality, but it has very powerful geographical effects because the extraction often happens from poorer parts of the country and is channeled to the richer parts of the country, but also it has racial dimensions. You know, the people, the most vulnerable people tend to be the ones extracted from. It has gender dimensions, you know, any kind of dimension of, you know, discrimination and inequality and so on, you will find that the finance curse worsens these dimensions in very hidden ways, often ways you don't, you know, they're very complicated to understand in their details. But I think ultimately it's a pretty simple concept. It's just, you know, money is being extracted from these communities, these areas, these you know, groups of people, and channeled to a relatively small group of, you know, mostly middle-aged white men in the big money centers.
And in your conclusion, I mean, you lay out some just sort of broad principles, I think, that we could follow to at the very least fix this ill of financialization, which essentially, you know, are in many ways just reimposing reforms that we had prior to, I don't know, the early 70s and through the 80s. I mean, things like stock buybacks, they were once illegal. They could be illegal again. A perspective on antitrust that looks at all of the implications of monopolization rather than just how cheap it is for people in the short run. What else is key in your mind?
Yeah, no, I think those are all very important. I think, you know, ultimately the most important thing is a reframing exercise. And I think that is definitely going on in the United States and the United Kingdom and other places. There has been this idea of, you know, the billionaires and the large multinationals as the wealth creators. But if we can start reframing them very significantly as the wealth extractors, you know, these are the people who, you know, one of the big secrets of the wealthiest people in this country is they don't like free markets. What they like is rigged markets. And I think people are increasingly able to see this. And once we can move away from the idea that we need to sort of support these rich people as the wealth creators and look at the wealth extraction strategies that they are involved in, monopolization and the use of tax havens and all these things that they're doing, we can actually start seeing that there's a whole load of democratic possibilities that become open to us, that we can start raising tax rates on wealthier people, we can and on multinationals. We can start putting in place strong antitrust and things like that. And not only will that reduce inequality and redistribute money towards and income and power towards, you know, the middle classes and ordinary people, but it will also increase overall economic growth and prosperity. It's kind of a win-win. And I think people at the moment are a bit hamstrung by the idea that if we, you know, tax the billionaires and do it too much, we'll damage economic growth. But once we realize that we can do, we can you know, bring back democracy, we can have both redistribution and you know, reduced inequality, but also higher economic growth and higher prosperity. There's really nothing to stop us.
Nicholas Shaxson, The Finance Curse, How Global Finance is Making Us All Poorer. We'll put a link at majority.fm. Thanks so much for your time today. Really appreciate it.
Great to talk to you. Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
There you go, folks. We're going to take a quick break. Head to the fun half, wherein we will have some fun. Just some programming notes. Right now, on Wednesday, it appears that Bill Taylor, the ambassador or former ambassador who was brought back to professionalize the so-called drug deal that Rudy Giuliani was up to in Ukraine, will be testifying publicly on Wednesday. In addition, Bill Kent, William Kent, is that his first name? George P. Kent, who is a State Department official, who is going to testify, I believe, as to sort of the attempts to get rid of the first EU, successful attempts to get rid of the first EU ambassador. They are putting together the case that Donald Trump extorted, bribed two different sides of the same coin, or attempted to. Get the Ukrainians to, at the very least, say there was an investigation into the Bidens and there was an investigation into the 2016 election, so as to apparently give something for Donald Trump to run on in 2020. Now, apparently Lev Parnas today or yesterday, or I guess Friday, testified something to the effect of that Rudy Giuliani was pushing for a quid pro quo. I need to look more into that. I did portray Lev Parnas on Halloween because I saw a picture of him with a medallion. That was the only thing I had. Good to know that's getting into the news more so that people can, in retrospect, appreciate my costume even more. We will do live streaming of those hearings. I think they start at 10 a.m. on Wednesday. I'll be in and doing that, and then we'll see as we get closer to the show. We were planning a news day for Wednesday anyways, so we will see what's happening. But I'm going to be watching those, so if you want to watch them with me, you will have the opportunity to do so Wednesday morning. And aside from that, everything will be regularly scheduled. Thursday, we may be starting just a little bit earlier, and we may flip things. We'll do the fun half for live viewers first and the interview second. So just set your calendars and your clocks and all that. I know everybody is doing that. So
like eating dessert first.
It's, we're going to have like, yeah, eat dessert will come first on Thursday. In the meantime, just a reminder, your support makes this show possible. You can become a member by going to jointhemajorityreport.com. When you become a member, you not only support the free show, you get it without commercials. You also get extra content every day, and you help this show grow. And we've added the AM Quickie. Folks are enjoying that. You can sign up for that at amquickie.com. You can access it through the app. Should tell you that the iOS and the Android apps have been going through continuous, what seems like just like nonstop updating. If you downloaded it a day ago, update it now. All the features that you loved before and more are there on the majority app. So check that out. Also, don't forget justcoffee.coop, fair trade coffee to your chocolate. Use the coupon code majority to get 10% off. So check that out. Today is Monday, which means that tomorrow is Tuesday, but the show is not happening on Tuesday. It's happening today on Monday.
Indeed. Schedule change. Richard Wolf is here. Shahid Buttar is here in studio.
Oh, really?
Yeah, actually. And I should let everybody know, tomorrow I'm emceeing an event at Catch Astoria in Queens for Shahid Buttar. It'll be like a small grassroots fundraiser. And I know Nomiki's going to be there. Isaiah James, who's a great progressive running for Congress. And Peter Dow. So
Peter Dow, man,
he's on it. He has not played around with his transformation.
Welcome to the left. See the left. Welcome to open arms.
Absolutely. I look forward to shaking Peter Dow's hand. So we're going to be talking extensively, obviously, on the coup in Bolivia, on Lula, and then with Richard Wolf, we have some broader themes to hit, including the history. What exactly was the Soviet Union? And he's going to give us an introduction to the 18th Brumaire by Marx. Patreon.com/TMBS. Michael Brooks Show on YouTube. Pre-stream starting at 6. Become a patron. Get the whole thing. Get your tickets to the Philly live show November 23rd with Krystal Ball. Emma Vigeland, Artesia Balthrop. All links are on the website.
Jamie.
This week on the Antifada, Sean had on some of two of his fellow building tradesmen to talk all things union. They discussed their own work histories and how they became radicalized through their experiences. Sean actually met one of these guys at a Capital Reading Group, so that's cute. They poke holes in this J.D. Vance white working class mythos that sees cultural regression and Trumpism as this sort of essentialist thing divorced from material factors. And they talk about the structures they've encountered in their particular unions and how the working class can overcome the provincialism and conservatism of business unionism. Because as we know, some of these trades unions can be very conservative, and that's not what we want. Also, Sean did a bonus with Billy O'Connor where they talk some more about some of their experiences on the job and in the union, in the trades. Also, I just recorded an episode over the weekend with all three members of the Trillbilly Workers Party podcast, and I'm very excited about that. And that's going to be out for all of our patrons on Friday.
Matt.
Yeah, folks, check out my Salem Witch Trials episode. And also coming up, it's going to be released probably sometime this week for members and then on Saturday for everybody. But Afroben, her story, Orinoco, the Royal Slave. It's one of the early examples. It's not quite a novel, but it's an early example of prose fiction, and it's about a slave that gets captured, and it's bad because he's actually royalty. So it's not really an anti-slave narrative like some people like to think it is, but
don't give it away for free.
But yeah, okay, yeah, you'll check that out. So look forward to that, folks.
Oh my God, can I make one more recommendation? I totally forgot. If you want to understand the neoliberal turn of the 1970s from a Marxist perspective, check out History as a Weapon, Pivotal Decade, the 1970s with Sean KB and Matt Chrisman. It's very good.
Also, Globalists on MR and Quince Lodian's essays.
This episode is brought to you by Blinkist. The Blinkist app takes the key takeaways from thousands of best-selling nonfiction books and condenses them down into just 15 minutes for you to read or listen to. 10 million people are using Blinkist right now, but there's room for you. It has a massive growing library from self-help to business to health and history books. Right now, you can get 25% off your first year at Blinkist.com/majority. See you in the fun half.
You are in for it.
All right, folks, 646-257-3920. See you in the fun half.
Who sent us this?
Alpha males are back, 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 boy is back, and the alpha males are back, back.
Just as delicious as you can imagine.
The alpha males are back, 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 boy is back, and the alpha males are back, 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 back.
Just wanna degrade the white man.
Alpha males are back, back.
I take all of it in my throat.
Alpha males are back, 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 back.
Almost says what?
The alpha males are back, 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 back.
You are a madman!
And the alpha males are back, back, back.
I am a total cunt.
Can we bring back DJ Danerke's song, please?
Yeah, or a couple of them. Just put them in rotation.
DJ Danerke.
Well, the problem with those is they're like 45 seconds long, so I don't know if they're enough of a break for people.
That's fucking nonsense.
Hey, folks, fucking reminder.
I do not have Parkinson's.
And the alpha males are
psych. Fuck them. Fuck them.
Homo says what?
What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What?
What? What? What? What?
What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What? What?
Have you tried doing an impression on a college campus?
I think that there's no reason why reasonable people across the divide can't all agree with this. Psych.
And the alpha males are back, 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 back. And the Africans are black, 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 black African. And the alpha males are back, 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 back. And the Africans are black, 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 black.
Donald Trump out there, doesn't a little part of you think that America deserves to be taken over by jihadists? Keep it at 100. Can't knock the hustle. Come on!
Fuck them! Fuck them! Fuck them! Fuck them! Fuck them! Things I do for the bigger game plan.
By the way, it's my birthday!
My birthday!
Happy birthday to me, Jew boy!
I have a thought experiment for you.
And the alpha males are back, back. Africans are black, black. Alpha males are back, back. Africans are black.
Blaster, blast me around here.
I am a total
pussy, 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 pussy.
We. Oh my God. Just the idea of Brett Stevens and Anthony Scaramucci, who are going to explain the world to us, ladies and gentlemen.
Who's smarter, you think?
This is
Scaramucci.
Bad bug.
Without a doubt.
I agree.
It really is amazing. I have to be honest. With you. I don't spend a lot of time watching MSNBC. To be fair, I also have never seen a full episode of Bob's Burgers.
Really missing out.
And
man.
I'm on that. I don't know if it's just a function of something that I'm involved in. I have less interest. Although I've watched a lot of Chris Hayes at times. I mean, relatively speaking, I just don't watch that much cable news these days. I have not been on that often. I think part of that is a function of there's an ebb and flow to these shows, and impeachment is making a obviously is taking up a lot of time on these shows, and I don't do day side. I just, I'm not available. I've got too much other things to do. So really, there's limited opportunity. So I'm not making more of it. But the idea that like Brett Stevens and Anthony Scaramucci are on MSNBC, I mean, frankly, the idea that either one of them are on anywhere saying anything about anything seems rather ridiculous to me. But the idea of them on, here's Brett Stevens. Run, Mike, run. You know, it's amazing. This guy, Brett Stevens, how much has Brett Stevens written about how much the college campuses are causing real Americans
to, you know, be pushed into a corner and having to vote for Donald Trump. And I don't even know if I've ever read an entire Bret Stephens column, but I feel like 90% of his pieces are about that. Maybe that's a bit of an exaggeration.
Also, Palestinians aren't human.
But that is his, what do you call it?
Bailiwick?
Yeah, that's his value add, I think. And here he is. So both that guy who's saying, like, you know, you have no idea what the heartland wants. And then sort of approving that point by saying that Mike Bloomberg, or even like contemplating that Mike Bloomberg is going to do well in any part of the country under any circumstances. Now, I do think Bloomberg should be able to take a couple of points away from Biden and from Buttigieg.
Run, Mike, run.
So I would also add, run, Mike, run, but I don't think it's for the same reason.
Best thing Bloomberg's ever done for the country.
Okay. There are two great arguments for Mike Bloomberg. Number one, he would be a very good and potentially a great president. He was a great mayor of New York City. And number two, he can beat Trump. And if your number one priority as a Democrat is to beat Trump with someone who broadly shares your values, maybe not on everything, but basically shares your values, he can do it. Why? He defeats Trump's money advantage, and he defeats Trump's number one argument against the Democrats, which is whether you love me or hate me, you got to vote for me. And that's what Trump is saying, especially to voters who are afraid of the progressivism of Sanders or Warren, or feel that Biden is perhaps a feeble champion for the moderate Democrats. He has those arguments locked down. So
pause it. Hold on for one second. Let's just analyze. Okay, the I could make an argument that to the extent that Mike Bloomberg was a great mayor of New York, I think he was a great mayor for a narrow set of people. To the extent that he was able to get stuff done, it was because he was literally paying out of his pocket to grease certain wheels, which I don't think on a national level, A, he will do, but B, we should be doing, because there's, if you think government overreach is a problem, wait till you get a load of private government overreach. But aside from that, the proposition and the idea that the New York Times would pay this guy whatever sum of money they pay him for him to say things like this that are completely baseless. There is not one shred, one data point that any of us here or anywhere could not just conjure up, aside from what we could conjure, that reinforces the argument that Michael Bloomberg could beat Donald Trump better than Bernie Sanders, Elizabeth Warren, or Joe Biden for that. I mean, it is the truth that I think that Joe Biden is feeble. I'm not convinced that he, and I do think that his prospects would be shaky in a general election just because I think he's going to run out of gas. But there's not a shred, not an iota of data, a poll that just went off in the, because any generic Democrat can do well, that his money advantage, Hillary Clinton had a money advantage over Donald Trump. What possible difference does that make? And I'm sorry, the idea that Michael Bloomberg's going to go into Michigan or to Wisconsin or to, mid-state Pennsylvania and wrap up votes, it's possible, but there's no data to support that. And this guy writes for the New York Times, but continue.
Champion for the moderate Democrats. He has those arguments locked down. So I think that's a pretty strong case for running for president.
Anthony, you know the debate about billionaires. You know a couple, two or three.
Yeah.
He's a billionaire, 50 plus billion. Is he the billionaire that does not appear to be a billionaire, or will he fit into that category?
Well, I think that's one of the problems. I mean, Basil knows this better than me, but I think there's a billionaire-itis on that side of the
side.
Yeah. Well, to me, but I think he could transcend that as well. I think he's a transformative figure, and I think Brett is right. If he gets in there, I don't understand the strategy. Maybe these guys could explain it, but I would be in there in Iowa tonight, and I'd just be pushing every state, because people, once they meet him, they realize, oh my God, this guy reeks of competence and intelligence, and he'll do the right thing and the country will be safe.
You were sick of billionaires, but then I came along and I said, first of all, listen, you pieces of garbage, you're not going to tax me and my friends, but I will take your sodas away. Do you feel refreshed by my competence?
The big slushies was the best thing that he did. That, I think, is all well and good. Just the
idea.
Well,
that's coming on a federal level, so get ready.
Just the idea that this guy's going to go in and clean up is just, it's just stunning. It really is stunning.
The mooch doesn't even sound like he believes it himself.
Yeah, I know.
He's like, he's a transformative figure.
Yeah, mooch's audience is other billionaires that might be like watching the TV.
No, mooch ain't no billionaire. But I mean, can
well,
I just
no,
say,
I'm
though,
saying like
a,
he wants billionaire
oh,
cash.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Hey, Bezos. Besides, but can I just say, I mean, setting aside the specifics of the slushy policy, whatever, there is a structural understanding. Like, a guy who fought every possible effort to halt gentrification and homelessness and do anything big picture for public health in this city, to zero in on penalizing people for a personal consumer choice, I have a problem with. I don't like that way of looking at things.
Oh, and by the way,
not
Biden
that I mean, of course, I hate
is
slushy.
Way more charismatic than Bloomberg in the places that you're going to need to win.
Little Mike, look at the picture.
It's just, it's pretty stunning.
Okay, Bloomberg.
The heartland is screaming out. Just like, you know what I really want? Just like a fellow who'd come and tell me that I'm stupid and the jobs will never come back.
It's weird how it's like their job, though.
I'm looking for an effete New York Jew billionaire. And when that guy comes around, as long as he's under 5'7", I'm voting for it.
You know,
boom.
You know what I literally,
that's my, when I think president, I'm a moderate. And so I'm a moderate. So I'm looking for socially liberal. But I mean, that's the thing. Is
we
that
need
like,
to progress as a society. So I
you
like
know,
the fact
I,
that Mike
wait a second. Let me amend what I said. I also want somebody in there who spent hundreds of millions of dollars to take my gun away.
Okay, true story.
That's the guy I'm gonna vote for.
True story. I was visiting two friends of mine who were at Yale getting PhDs like 5 years ago. We were talking about, yeah, very smart friends, tremendous people. And one of my friend Luke, his fiance was talking about Bloomberg, and she was like basically like, you know, oh, I think he might appeal to people. I like what he does on guns, blah, blah, blah. And me and this other guy who was went on to become a Republican strategist were both telling her, like, I think most people hate Michael Bloomberg outside of like a 5 foot radius of this conversation. And I swear to God, this guy two tables down, he's like, you know, I'm sorry to interrupt. I just want to let you guys know I'm literally like handlebar mustache. He's like, you know, I'm kind of all over the place politically. And, you know, he's really nice. Like, not trying to be rude, you know, but your friends are right. He's like, I own a gun shop. So, of course, I don't like what Mike's trying to do on guns. But I also think literally like I think people need health care. I think he's a little greedy. He literally was like the most McLuhan moment I've ever. And then, you know, he went and did his like whatever. I think it was like, you know, I voted for Obama, but I vote for a lot of Republicans. I hate Mike Bloomberg. I hate him.
I honestly think like Mike Bloomberg's slogan should be the politician you didn't know you hated yet.
Boom. Winner.
Unbelievable. Let's go to the phones for a moment. Calling from a 319 area code. Who's this? Where are you calling from? 319. Adieu. To you and you. Let me get the IM going here. There we go. IMs are up, folks. You can IM us through the app at majorityapp.com. Here is Pramila Jayapal explaining why choice in private healthcare is a total fallacy that We think we have it because the news media keeps telling us that we do.
So help me understand how you respond to that concern that you're forcing people to do something they may not want to do.
Yeah. Well, I would just say we don't have choice today. Even if you have government, even if you have private insurance, what choice do you really have? You don't have a choice of what plan you pick. Your employer chooses that. You don't have a choice of what benefits are there. Your insurance, private insurance company chooses that. In fact, more and more, because of the rising healthcare costs, insurance companies are limiting who you get to see, what hospital is in network or out of network. And if you lose your job, you really have no choice at all. You got no health insurance. That's if you have insurance now. If you don't have insurance, what choice do you have now? So if that's choice, then I would rather have the choice of having a guaranteed insurance plan no matter where you work. You want to start a small business? You want to run a small business? You want to leave your job and go do something else? You get sick and you need to stay home? You have to take care of a loved one? You have that choice.
I mean, if I came up with an alternate name for Medicare for All, now, and we know Medicare for All, it's really not Medicare for All. Medicare requires a copay. Medicare requires a premium payment. Medicare does not cover the wide range of what is in the Medicare for All bill that Sanders introduced in the Senate, and it was a Jay Apal introduced in the House.
Yes.
That it's really closer to Medicaid for All, but Medicaid has more of a stigma attached to it, I guess. Medicare
means
is
testing.
Yes, means testing. So Medicare for All was the name they set it on. But the other name, the alternate name that I would give it, would be guaranteed health insurance. Because
freedom
it is guaranteed in every circumstance. You will never lose it. It will always be there. Guaranteed, unlike private health insurance, which is not guaranteed. It is not guaranteed. You could lose your job. You could, they could change the policy. The policy could go away. Not guaranteed. You're not guaranteed to get eye care. You're not guaranteed to get dental care. You're not guaranteed to have coverage for this or for that. This is completely guaranteed. So I'm glad to see Jay Apal using that term. And this is going to be a big fight going forward. Going to be a big fight in the context as these races heat up even more. We got the next debate is coming. When is it? The 20th? So we shall see. I suspect that's going to be even more engaged. Train boy on the IM. The only thing moderate about Michael Bloomberg is his height. Now, let's come on. Hardwood, hey guys, Matt wins the Babbel Challenge. Can you force him to do an episode of his podcast in French? Can't wait to listen to La Gueule des Bois Littéraire. Left is best.
Not going to happen.
I might go on my friend's Spanish language podcast that he's going to start where he just talks mad shit on everyone in Spanish.
H. John Benjamin. I find that hard to believe. Hey, Sam. Just heard you don't watch Bob's Burgers. Well, you can say goodbye to any future episodes and the movie. A lot of money out the window. Better hope YouTube doesn't ban you. Look forward to your GoFundMe in a few years to keep you loving in the heartland of America, pal. Local pizza historian. Me. Man, do I feel guilty about my role in my military service. Also me. Why, yes, Olive Garden. I do deserve a free chicken Alfredo. Tim Pool's mom. Sam, as you know, I'm normally very liberal. However, today is Veterans Day, and if you haven't even mentioned the troops yet, so now I'm all right. See what you've done? Well, I started the show off, Mrs. Poole, talking about Veterans Day, so you are wrong. Michael's diaper fetish. Can Jamie read her plug again? It was too short. I didn't catch it. Teacher Lauren. Hey, Sam, the birthday show far made my day on Friday. Love you all. I'm glad it did. Sam Fan 1. Sup, Sambo. I, too, hate Bloomberg. Davos Oakhart. Have you guys heard of Joe Biden's new plan to fight climate change? He wants to replace Air Force One with the Amtrak One and replace all cars with electronic trolleys. Then he finishes his speech by saying, I'm Amtrak Joe, and blowing raspberries. I don't know if it's brain slush or serious, but he won my vote.
Really?
I think it's a joke.
I don't get it.
Speaking of Joe Biden, And we'll get to tomorrow on the program. We're going to have Mark Weisbrot on to talk about what's going on in Bolivia and our part in promoting what is going on in Bolivia. And we should say also, there was a an attempt at regime change during the Obama administration as well. We'll talk about that tomorrow.
Evo won. It's a coup. Don't be a nerd.
Well, I mean, you know it's a coup. Do we have that clip of them? We'll play this tomorrow, I guess. The clip, when your military members feel it's necessary to wear a mask as they walk out like two prisoners in front of this sort of star chamber on TV, that's a good sign. Maybe this is a little dubious. But we'll watch that tomorrow. We'll get the whole show demonetized that way, and we'll just do it all in one fell swoop. But here is, speaking of Latin America, here is Joe Biden. And is this a compilation?
Yeah, it is.
Okay. Now, as you know, Bernie Sanders, I think, was the only person to even sort of like comment on what was going on in Brazil. I'm not sure of that 100%.
Only person to call for freeing Lula and the only one to sign the congressional letters on the broader situation.
Right. I mean, it's conceivable that others have mentioned it in certain points. In fact, Joe Biden certainly has been talking about, because here's the thing. Joe, on day one, he's going to come in and he's going to know foreign relations. All right. That part of the job, he doesn't have to worry about. This guy studied in every part of the country, every part of the world. Okay. So this is his knowledge of this stuff is not like Dave Rubin-esque. Okay. It's not like, oh, I saw a tweet. And this guy has dug into this stuff. So he knows Lava Jato. He knows Bolsonaro or Bolsonaro or Bodasoreso or let's hear him say it.
And they have to respond, just like I will make Bolsonaro the president of Brazil. And I would make it clear to Bolsonaro.
Do you realize Bolsonaro, the president of Brazil?
Now, look, it's possible that he just keeps flubbing the names. I flub names all the time. I'm not running for president. And ostensibly speaking, you know, when I say things, I don't think that just my proclamations as a potential United States president in any way impact world events. But I think if you're going to get up there and make an argument as to your deep, deep expertise and your day one readiness about dealing with crises around the world, you know, the president of Brazil's name might be important.
I also, just a quick anecdote, I remembered this. I read Bill Bradley's book, Time Present, Time Past, which is his memoir of basketball in the Senate.
I think you'll find it's Bill Bradley.
Bill Bradley, excuse me, pardon me. Bill Bradley, the senator.
Braldy,
the senator from New Jersey. And he had an anecdote about, he was on a trip, I think it was still the Soviet Union, or maybe it was just collapsing, but he and Biden were there. And one thing that's fun about the book is that Braldy allows himself to be a little bit snarky about other senators. And he says that Biden did this whole show of telling this Soviet official, don't shit a shitter. I don't know what the context was, but Joe Biden, whatever. And after Broadly said, he pulled the translator aside and he said, how did you translate that? And the guy looked at him and said, not literally.
Bolsonaro.
You know, it is possible that he's just butchering his name as like a power move. Like,
that's right.
We
do, yeah, he's being alpha.
You know?
I do that sometimes. I
it's like a fun way to disrespect someone.
If Biden was tweeting out in support of Lula for the past few months, then he would be allowed to pronounce
absolutely
it Bolsonaro.
Yep. He certainly could, and he would also be second choice.
So Lula is free, and he is in his hometown of San Bernardo del Campo.
That's a area of São Paulo. It's a workers' area. That's where he lives.
Speaking out against Bolsonaro's privatization and the killing of Marilla Franco. It's from the Real News.
During Lula's first speech back home in São Bernardo do Campo on Saturday, he railed against Bolsonaro's widespread privatization plan and his alleged connections with the paramilitaries accused of killing Rio de Janeiro councilwoman Marielle Franco last year. Bolsonaro was democratically elected. We accept the results of the election. This guy has a mandate for 4 years. But he was elected to govern for the Brazilian people and not to govern for the paramilitaries in Rio de Janeiro.
There you go. He's out. He's free, freed by the Supreme Court essentially the Supreme Court in Brazil. More on that going forward. I haven't heard like sort of Bolsonaro's response to this.
Well, Bolsonaro hasn't said much. Sergio Moro, the corrupt judge that put him in jail, put out a tweet about how, like, I'm not going to respond to criminals or something. And Glenn Greenwald quote tweeted him and said, like, you're a corrupt regional judge. He's an international statesman. I'm not sure who should be ignoring who or something.
Burn.
So, across the ocean, as you know, there is going to be a vote in, was it the second week of December, was it? December 12th? I can't remember when the next, you better figure it out or we're just going to kick you out, Brexit deadline is. There's been, I feel like there's been like 10, right? Or has it been like closer to like 6? But nevertheless, Labor is picking up a little bit of momentum. I don't follow these things too closely, but my understanding is that is the case. And of course, the ongoing persistent argument against Jeremy Corbyn is that he is anti-Semitic. Here is John Bierkow. He is the former speaker. And he's the guy who, in the House of Commons,
yeah.
He is the one who functions as the parliamentarian.
Oh, I love that guy. The one who goes, oh, duh.
Yeah. Yes.
It's like the cafeteria supervisor.
Right. We don't have that. We don't really have that in this country. We have a Speaker of the House or we have someone who has the gavel, but it's not... They're not really refereeing in the same way.
Well, they need it over there. They're so cantankerous. I love it.
And this guy apparently is Jewish. Is that right?
He's Jewish, and it should be. I mean, he's a member of the Conservative Party, so he functions in a nonpartisan way, and politically, his trajectory has definitely been from the right to the center.
He even says he was a right winger.
Yes, in this clip, yeah. I mean, he's certainly a buddy. I mean, he's not a left winger. He was an actual moderate, which occasionally still exists in the UK. And he is Jewish.
That's right. And you need to be a moderate, I think, probably to do that job well. And that's probably why they picked him.
You need to have that capacity, yes.
Here he is being interviewed by Alistair Campbell.
Who is Tony Blair's former top spin doctor.
For British GQ, actually. And on his opinion as to Jeremy Corbyn's anti-Semitism or not.
One final thing. You're Jewish. What's your sense been of the Labour Party anti-Semitism debate?
I think that racism is a challenge across society. And after decades in which huge advances were made, I think there is a real danger of regression now. Now, I know you didn't ask more widely about racism, but that's my answer on racism. You asked about anti-Semitism. And I think it is a big challenge. I don't want to intrude on the grief of a particular political party. All I would say is that, yes, it's an issue and it needs to be addressed. that I myself have never experienced anti-Semitism from a member of the Labour Party, point one. And point two, though there is a big issue and it has to be addressed, I do not myself believe Jeremy Corbyn is anti-Semitic. That is my honest view. You haven't asked me explicitly, but you've nevertheless drawn me, and I want to make that point. I'm not saying that he doesn't have a challenge in his party. I'm not saying that. It is an issue and it does need to be addressed, and I respect those who are very concerned about it, but I don't believe Jeremy Corbyn is anti-Semitic. I've known him for the 22 years that I've been in Parliament, even actually when I was a right winger, we got on pretty well. He was quite a personable
Well, you probably voted
individual.
Voted with him more often than he did with the Labour government.
Well, he was certainly a persistent and prolific rebel. He's been very supportive of me. He's been very supportive of me, and I've never detected so much as a whiff of anti-Semitism.
Have you ever experienced anti-Semitism outside Parliament? You said you hadn't experienced it from anybody in the Labour Party. What about outside Parliament?
Yes. Yes, I have.
Like?
Well, I remember somebody once saying to me, and I'm not going to say who, somebody once saying to me, you know, if I had my way, people like you, Berkoff, wouldn't be in this place. And I said to this individual, when you say people like me, do you mean people like me in the sense that I'm lower class or Jewish? To which he replied, both.
Now, we know that person wasn't in the Labour Party. I have no sense of how to place that in British society. Like if there was some argument that Bernie Sanders was anti-Semitic, and Barack Obama came out, or, you know, I don't know, I don't know who would come out, you know, I don't know, you know, Rick Santorum would come out and say, I've known Bernie Sanders for a long time, he's not anti-Semitic. Like, I could place that, the relevance of that. I don't know if that type of statement from a, at least from the perspective of an American, he seems not necessarily powerful, but at least prominent. And in terms of his pedigree, it seems to me that that would be relevant. I wonder how much that's going to sort of quiet those charges.
Well, I don't think it'll quiet them, because that's been the strategy, you know, from the beginning. But I don't know what the direct analog is, but that one, it matters.
It'll impact the media class.
That's the type of thing that you can't ignore, somebody of that stature just wiping away a narrative like that. I mean,
the Times, for instance, are going to be like, oh, okay. Like,
yeah. And it's also just a ready-made clip. Like, you know, don't take us crazy Labour supporters' words for it. Take the Tory former parliamentary speaker.
That's why we played it. I mean,
exactly.
We're not playing a lot of clips every day about the British elections, but that one seems to be pretty spot on. I mean, I don't know what else you need to do. There is no place where you can send away for a card that says, I'm not anti-Semitic.
And anti-Semitism is a much bigger problem in the UK, we should add. Like, 9 times out of 10, when you hear it thrown around in American politics, it's this baseless distraction. But, like, it is more of a problem over there.
Yes. The that story that he tells does not shock me.
Well, right. And that's the other part of the dynamic. I mean, can I take 30 seconds on it?
Yeah.
There is an element in the Labour Party where, one, there is like some, it's still over exaggerated. A lot of it is still confused with criticizing Israel, but there is occasionally like sentiments on the left there that you will hear that are like, oh, that does actually sound like anti-Semitism, unlike here, which is what Jamie was saying. Then there's also like some, again, not all, but in terms of reality, some, and this goes back under Blair, there's some like, predominantly like local Muslim constituencies where it's like, oh, that's another aspect of it. People involved in the Labour Party saying things that sound anti-Semitic. But again, anti-Israel versus anti-Semitic, even there is a really big distinction. And this is all on top of the fact that clearly the person he's talking about there, at least in my interpretation, is some type of Tory party grandee. And there is no coverage of like a old style, old world, profound anti-Semitism along with anti-Muslim, anti and racist bigotry, which is like just the norm in the Tory party.
Not to mention the way that we fight the rising tide of fascism worldwide is with some sort of leftist internationalism. Like, there's no way around it. So I know he wasn't speaking on that level, but that is also true about Corbyn.
This is becoming a fun genre of video. And this actually has two things that I like about it. Both the subversion of a national narrative that we all seem to like, I don't know. I mean, I will grant that I read mostly the political press. So I don't know what's going on in the sort of mainstream news narrative beyond that. But there seems to be just sort of like a complete like, well, he killed himself, in quotes. We might as well no longer investigate any of the other things that we were talking about when it comes to Jeffrey Epstein. So I appreciate people dropping this. And then I also appreciate that, these young people are extremely media savvy and understand what it takes to get on television and what you got to do and how you sucker in some of these field reporters. And I welcome that. I welcome that with me. I think that's great. And I also appreciate the fact that he made another statement. If you watch this guy, if you watch his pin, it's right on the chest there. He's got a Trump pin. That's why he's approached by this reporter on MSNBC at the what game was this? The Alabama
LSU
game.
Roll Tide.
Looking for Trump supporters in the youth. Here we go.
The three of you told me you voted for the president in 2016. You're supporters of his. Why do you like him so much, and what policies stand out to you that you support?
Well, I would say mainly just the no-nonsense policies, and especially since Jeffrey Epstein did kill himself. That's awesome, yeah. That's totally perfect.
Turning back to Alabama, you guys want to tell me a little bit about the Senate race? I noticed you have your buttons on here.
Watch the pin. Watch the pin.
Yes. Supporter of Bradley Byrne.
And there it goes.
He's running to be the next
U.S.
Senator,
that's fantastic. I love that.
And his smile at the end.
Yeah. Well, he's looking over. I think there must be a monitor or something, or his buddies are over to the. And there he goes. Boom. That guy.
The truth will get through.
Can't wait to show that to my son and say, grow up like this young man. And dad'll be proud. That's right. This is how you do that. Let me show you how you do that. Folks, there's something that's disturbing that's happening on the right. And I will have an offer at the end of this video because I think if anything, I am known as a unifier and a bringer together of people. That's one of the things that I, when people ask me tell me about yourself. That's what I say. I'm a bringer together of people. And there has been an ongoing fight between those people on the right who think they should be out and proud with their bigotry and those people on the right who don't think they should be. And so we have this Turning Points USA. Charlie Kirk is going around to various college campuses. And there's been an ongoing debate on the right. One side says, look, the fight about marriage equality is over. We no longer demonize gay people because we lost that battle. We have moved on to demonizing transgender people. And we will have no more talk of demonizing gay people because we're trying to appeal to younger people. And young people just see that and they think, like, these people are completely insane. But then there's another group of people on the right who say, no, we should stick to our principles And that is, we should continue to publicly disparage and discriminate against gay people. Not just gay people and transgender people. We should discriminate against all non-heterosexual people. And this is an ongoing... So Nicholas Fuentes is one of those people.
This is just 24 minutes ago talking about this.
And 24 minutes ago, Nicholas J. Fuentes wrote, "The media is getting this Don Jr. story all wrong. The UCLA event was heckled because Charlie Kirk has been trying to silence and smear a burgeoning America First youth movement on campus. It's only boiled over after he canceled the Q&A yesterday in anticipation of our questions. The real story is that Charlie Kirk is a total failure that continues to be humiliated by real nationalist conservatives. He's lost control of his own events. He has lost the confidence of young Trump supporters. It's unfortunate Don got swept up in this, but thank Kirk for that." There's an interesting divide here, like I say, between these two different parties. Here is what went on at that Charlie Kirk Turning Points USA event with Donald Trump Jr. and Donald Trump Jr.'s amour. What's her name again?
Kim Guilfoyle.
Kim Guilfoyle. And there are people who are yelling out, Q and A. And they are demanding that Donald Trump Jr. ask questions. And really, I'm a little bit surprised because Turning Points USA is usually about questions and ideas. That's
not
why
they're afraid of things.
Yeah, here we go.
Available to all Americans.
I think they're triggered, Don. It happens. But again, that's the difference between conservatives. Name a time where conservatives have disrupted even the furthest leftists on a college campus, right? It doesn't happen that way.
They're being disrupted by other conservatives. Now, I don't know if he's saying that, like, how come conservatives never disrupt liberals on campus, and why do they just disrupt us? I'm not sure.
They absolutely do.
Of course they do. Barry Weiss ran a whole campaign to get rid of professors who were in any way critical of Israel. But
Kianga Yamada Taylor has had to cancel appearances because she was getting death threats.
Of course. This happens all the time. But we can't look to Don Trump Jr. to be an honest broker in this situation. We can only watch and feel concern for what these conservative college students are doing on the campus by shutting down debate.
College campus, right? It doesn't happen that way. We're willing to listen.
Q&A!
We're willing to listen.
That was somebody shouting Q&A.
Q&A, because they've cut down. They basically eliminated the Q&A session.
I think they cucked out of the Q&A debate.
That's what we would say if we were on the right.
Exactly.
Even the furthest leftist on a college campus, right? It doesn't happen that way. We're willing to listen.
Q&A!
We're willing to listen.
Wow. It sounds like there's like 90% of the people there.
See what I mean? And that is the problem. And the reason oftentimes it doesn't make sense to do the Q&A is not because we're not willing to talk about the questions, because we do. Now, it's because people hijack it with nonsense looking to go for some sort of soundbite. You have people spreading nonsense, spreading hate to try to take over that room.
Disruptive and discourteous. We are happy to answer a question. Respect the people around you so that they can hear. You don't play by the same rules. Let me tell you something. I bet you engage and go on online dating because you're impressing no one here to get a date in person.
Okay. Now look, first off, we have read so many op-eds that have please have asked, stop mocking incels because all you're doing is making sure that Trump gets reelected. Now, when the Trump family starts to heckle incels, one wonders, is that going to get a Democrat elected?
Might as well just call them deplorables, Ken.
Yeah, exactly. Now, this is, and the other thing is that how many times, I mean, we've got, I would imagine right now that that sound you're hearing, that clicking, are all the people banging on their keyboards at the Washington Post and the New York Times in particular, decrying all of this complete rudeness and yelling and anger on this conservative on conservative violence. It's a real shame. Now, Nicholas Fuentes says all of this could have been avoided if Kirk had actually engaged honestly with me or the Groypers and our legitimate grievances.
There's actual people who call themselves Groypers now? I thought it was just like an alt-right cartoon.
No, there
That's
it is.
That's what Don Jr. wants, and Charlie Kirk wants you to think.
As would be consistent with his own, quote, marketplace of ideas shtick. It's true. They have Dave Rubin go around. I mean, he is the king of marketplace ideas. Instead, he has dismissed, ignored, and attacked us for our concerns. Hypocrite. Now, look, I'm going to lay all my cards on the table here. I think Nicholas Fuentes is reprehensible. I also think Charlie Kirk is reprehensible. But because I am well known as being a reasonable person who is willing to debate anybody, and I really am, I think we get to almost every, I mean, you can ask people around here, why are you doing that show? Just because they asked, and I have time, and that's basically it. In that spirit, I will make this offer to both Charlie Kirk, who I've debated, and I found him to be a very respectful debatee, and Nicholas Fuentes, who I know nothing about except for these tweets. I am going to make a public offer now. I am willing to moderate a debate between Nicholas Fuentes and Charlie Kirk. I will do it online. I will travel at my own expense because it's so important for me to see this exchange of ideas between these two campus conservatives. I am curious as to their differences. And I think it would be interesting for people to just hear a reasoned debate without the yelling. We can do it online, so there's no screaming or interruption. I make this offer, this public offer now. I will reiterate this on Twitter. We will tweet this out, and I want to help facilitate a debate between these two Americans. Make sure this is not copyrighted. Because I look at this yelling and screaming that's involving these folks, and I think it's a darn shame. And I just I've taken it to heart all of this problems that we have when college kids argue with each other. And so I want to help bridge this bridge. Nicholas, Charlie, I'm here for you guys. Just tell me when and where you feel comfortable, or I can facilitate it. I'll do either. I appreciate that. And good luck, guys. Please, let's keep exchanging those ideas.
Item number one, anal sex or destroying food stamps? As a conservative, what do we prioritize?
Well, that's the thing.
And I got to be like Mehdi Hasan, though. I have to answer one. I know they're both important to you. But there has to be one.
Well, there's a legitimate argument here on the right. Are you fulfilling the conservative mandate by immiserating people and allowing the vast majority of people and allowing just a few to hold power? Or do you, on the other side of it, do you immiserate people and allow just a few to hold power and just, slightly also discriminate against very specific people?
Well, those things have gone hand in hand through history.
Well, they have, and that's an interesting question to ask during the debate. Why wouldn't Charlie be on board for that? But we'll see.
I think Kirk will probably appreciate you setting up this marketplace, this exchange of ideas.
I just want what's best for everybody, and I think we know having this type of exchange of ideas is really the best way to go about this.
And you're neutral because you're disgusted by both of them.
That's right. I'm not going to favor either one of them. I'm not going to favor either one of them. I mean, you need an honest broker, and there couldn't be a more honest broker than myself.
You'll love to see it.
Yep. Here's Donald Trump on Friday explaining why he wanted the Department of Justice. Now, look, if you go through all of the testimony that has been given so far, and we're going to start to see the public testimony, NPR put together a handy dandy little breakdown. They said that the whistleblower complaint has been almost totally corroborated. This is why the whistleblower is not terribly relevant to the case anymore, because the whistleblower basically came out with a complaint that said there are these X number of people who came to me, and I'm aware of this secondhand. You got to go talk to them firsthand to corroborate it. Can't go ahead and impeach him based upon my whistleblower complaint. My whistleblower complaint is just a reflection of what they say. You go and see if it's true. And they went to these people, and they found this was corroborated. One, Rudy Giuliani's role in the pressure campaign to get Ukraine to the Ukrainian government to at least pretend that they were doing an investigation of Joe Biden and of the 2016 election. The details, which involved the recall of then U.S. Ambassador to Ukraine, Marie Yovanovitch, because she was a roadblock to this agenda. The withholding of military aid. And the moving of the now infamous July 25th call between Trump and Ukraine's president to a secure computer where you wouldn't have to, you're basically obstructing justice. You're hiding the evidence. The only thing that has not been corroborated, to the extent that we know, is that Attorney General Barr appears to be involved as well. Now, I don't know that the Democrats have pursued this. They're not going to, as of now, impeach Bill Barr. They should, in my estimation. It does not appear that they are going to. And here's Donald Trump explaining why he wanted the DOJ to investigate. Remember, we know Bill Barr has been traveling around the world, intimidating countries, asking them to get their intelligence services to support a narrative that, at the very least, when Mike Pompeo was head of the CIA, he would have said was fake. Now he's a little bit different. But at the time, he said the Russians interfered in the election, not the Ukrainians. But here's Donald Trump.
Bill Barr or anyone in your Department of Justice to investigate the Biden. And if not, you didn't ask them, why would you ask the president of Ukraine to do something you weren't willing to ask your own Justice Department
to
do?
We are looking for corruption. We're giving hundreds of millions of dollars, and we're looking for corruption.
Pause it.
You have to do.
Incidentally, New York Times reported about 2 weeks ago that the Trump administration has cut and has been seeking more cuts to anti-corruption measures in places like Ukraine.
Because of government bureaucracy.
Millions of dollars, and we're looking for corruption. And all you have to do is take a look at Biden, and you'll see tremendous corruption. Because what he did is quid pro quo times 10.
Did you ask your DOJ?
Let me just say, be quiet.
Did you ask your DOJ?
Are you ready?
Yes,
I never spoke to him about anything. It's up to Bill Barr. Bill Barr can do whatever he wants to do. But I saw the same tape on television, and the tape shows that Joe Biden is a crook. He's 100% crooked. And the fake news, which is you don't want to do anything about it.
We reported
his son walked out with millions of dollars from Ukraine, millions of dollars from China. He doesn't know anything. He walked away with a stash. It's a corrupt deal. It's a corrupt enterprise. And if the press did it right, it's a hell of a story.
There it is. Quid pro quo times 10.
Crooked Joe.
Deca quo, deca pro, I think is what it is in Latin. Yeah, he's getting a little testy. Little testy, ladies and gentlemen. But again, the name of the game when we talk about impeachment is ultimately what's going to happen in some of these Senate races and whatnot. Let's go to the phones, shall we? A lot of people holding. Let's see. Okay, calling from a 248 area code. Who's this? Where are you calling from?
This is Tyler from Great Falls, Montana.
Tyler from Great Falls, Montana. What's on your mind?
So I had questions with, like, how do you try to determine, like, what the reality on the ground is in these Latin American countries? Like, when we talk about an election is, like, rigged in, like, Venezuela or Bolivia, how do you, like, determine that? Is that just, like, Western media talking points? Like, how do you get a take on, like, what's going down?
Well, you know,
in that area of the world?
That's a legit question. And you know, tomorrow we're going to have Mark
Weisbrot
on, and he will make the argument that there has been no evidence, speaking specifically of Bolivia, that, and then we're talking about an October 20th election, that there's been no evidence that there was the cheating or fraud, election fraud, that that is ostensibly claimed by the U.S. and the Organization of American States. And really, I mean, I think it's, for me, it's just, I read these, you know, the competing breakdowns of these things and assess what sounds most credible to me. I mean, look, I can tell you this. I'm on the ground in the United States. And, you know, there are people on the ground in Georgia, let's say, the state of Georgia. And to what extent are we able to assess how many people were legitimately disenfranchised or not? To what extent are we able to assess, like, what are the implications of the confirmed, to the extent that we know, you know, because I have some skepticism about, you know, the FBI confirmed, you know, breaches into data files of voters. I mean, how do you make these assessments ever? I think really it's just you listen to two different arguments about it and or read them and assess which sounds more credible to you.
I also want to suggest, and this sounds, I think, you know, counterintuitive to people, probably be clipped against me, but that's fine. You should look at it ideologically to some extent, because, and it's a very hard balance to strike. I mean, there's legitimate criticisms to level at any of these governments, but the reality is that, one, if you take at face value that any representative of a right-wing force in Latin America cares about an independent judiciary and democratic transition and human rights, then you should enroll in Trump University immediately, and I have real estate opportunities for you. And so, you know, the geostrategic reality is that in all of these situations, the right-wing alternative that is backed by the United States will, A, not improve the areas that people may be concerned about, and B, will undoubtedly make and reverse the gains that these governments have achieved. I mean, Bolivia has radically cut poverty. The average height of Bolivian citizens has increased. I mean, this is real stuff. And one other thing I just want to say to media criticism, I mean, people, the New York Times put out a thing saying, you know, this shows, he's been in power since 2006, this shows the problems with staying on for so long. And number one, there's no mention of the word coup, which this literally is. Number two, as my friend Andre Du Mois points out, Angela Merkel's been in power in Germany since 2006. Like, you need to just be very aware of the cliches that get repeated, because there is concentrated, aggressive opposition to all of these governments. And you could take them one by one, and there's big differences inside them, but the bottom line is that local oligarchs and U.S. interests oppose them uniformly, and that's bad for poor people and bad for indigenous people.
Does that make sense?
Okay. Yeah. Could I ask you another question in regards to Latin America real quick?
Sam?
Yeah.
Okay. You've spoken before about like the longevity of like Castro's regime. How durable do you think our democracies in Latin America? And like, are those preferable, or would you go with like a more authoritarian socialist style system?
Well, in my ideology, in my ideology, I wouldn't. But the thing I would say is, I would say one, how real is a democracy? That's something you got to ask yourself. And two, historically, if you look at one of the reasons that the Cuban Revolution went ruthless was because they saw what happened in Guatemala. In the 1950s, you had a moderate government take power in Guatemala on moderate land reform and land redistribution, and in fact, actually democratizing. And they were viciously put down in a CIA coup. And I got to tell you, if you're a leftist in Latin America right now, what is the lesson of the last several years? You had a wave of governments that won undisputed elections. So I'm not justifying it, but you do have to historicize it and look critically at it. And at the very least, they all need to have a serious plan as to how to reform their police and militaries. There's no doubt about that.
Yeah. You really cannot blame them for becoming more centralized and authoritarian, specifically over the police and the military, after seeing what happens to people who don't do that.
I'm a little suspect of that. I mean, part of the reason why Cuba was so successful is that for an extended period of time, they had their economy artificially maintained by the Soviet Union. And,
Bolivia's economy is rocking. And I mean,
to be fair, simultaneously, they also had their economy artificially disabled by the United States. So, I mean, it cuts both ways.
Neither of those things were artificial. They were competing interests, helping or hurting the countries that they agreed or disagreed with.
Extraordinary. Let's put it that way. Most countries don't have that push and pull that is going on with them, which is, you know, makes things harder to manage.
As respects. Richard Wolff said, Mr. Castro showed the way.
Calling from a 443 area code. Who's this? Where are you calling from?
Hey, how you guys doing? It's Dan from Baltimore.
Dan from Baltimore. What's on your mind?
Every time I watch the Democratic debates, it seems like Bernie constantly goes into his stump speech. And, I mean, obviously they intentionally try to distract from the significance of so many of his policies. But, you know, do we kind of have a chance of cutting through some of the BS on a national stage? Or is it really just people like you and Kyle Kulinski and then allies in Congress that need to push the details of his agenda?
I think, you know, that'll change when there's fewer people on stage. I mean, when you have 12 people on stage in 2.5 hours or whatever it is, I mean, you do the math, you're only going to have so many minutes to speak. And so what they all, I think, try and do to a large extent is to just stay on message and deliver more or less their stump speech, as it were, because it's just a way for them to get access to more people.
It's really going to be awkward if they try that when there's just like Bernie, Biden, and Warren on stage.
Right. I mean, when there's less people, you can't get away with that, and you don't want to. You have more opportunity to speak, and so break things down a little bit more. Calling from a 347 area code. Who's this? Where are you calling from?
Hi, Storm. It's Kevin from New York, from the Bronx, New York. And I just wanted to say, love this show. My one question is, as a Bernie supporter, what's the line between saying, as a thought experiment, let's say Bernie is down 10 and Warren is at 21, Biden is at 23, and Bernie's at 11 in the polls. do you still think that in that particular scenario, one should vote Bernie? Or would you say, you know, vote for Warren because Warren has the best chance to win?
Okay. And your phone really stinks, so I don't want to hold you on too long. But what are you saying? Is this, you mean, if tomorrow the polling reflected that, or if it reflects that March?
No, in March.
I mean, after Super Tuesday?
Whatever particular state you're in. Let's say you're in Iowa, and the day before Iowa, Warren was up,
I've been saying for a long time that, like, you know, we need to see what happens in Iowa because Bernie has a very specific and pronounced, different than all the other candidates. And I don't say this because I'm supportive of him. This is, I think, you know, pretty explicit that their theory of their campaign is that they're going to be bringing out voters who necessarily would be outside the models of likely voters in a place like Iowa. Now, if Bernie comes in third or fourth in Iowa, let's say, I would start getting very skeptical. And I would then basically wait till Nevada. And then in the scenario you're talking about, I would start to entertain that. But I think, you know, I don't think that's going to happen. But I think, you know, I think there's going to be a time at one point, it's possible, if Buttigieg or Biden or Bloomberg, any of the bees, you know, are hanging in there and look like they may be the beneficiaries of a split on the votes on the left, then I think if you're a Warren supporter and Bernie is out in front, I think you need to do some hard thinking. If you're a Bernie supporter and Warren is out in front, then I think you need to do some hard thinking. I wouldn't make those determinations, you know, until, you know, deeper into the primary. But you also got to remember that presumably, you know, Bernie and Warren will be supporting and throwing their support if it gets closer to a convention. And I think in the scenario you're talking about, we may very well see some type of brokered convention. So I think that, you know, people should, if you want to vote for Bernie, you vote for Bernie. If you want to vote for Warren, you vote for Warren, and you wait and see. Maybe if you're in like a late state, you know, you can start to make that type of determination. But I just don't see the value of it up front. But I appreciate the call.
Vote for who you want. The polls have been wrong before, and they could be wrong again.
I mean, I would just
also I can see. All right, I'm not saying that I would prefer Biden over Warren, but there is a stronger case for Biden being able to beat Trump.
That is, I suppose there is a case. It's a really bad one, and I doubt it. I'm willing to have that debate.
Bloomberg, if we're being honest, would crush all of them.
Call him from a 479 area code. Who's this? Where are you calling from?
Yes, and this is Greg from Little Rock.
Greg from Little Rock, what's on your mind?
Yes, I'm calling about the Little Rock Teachers Union.
Oh.
They announced a strike starting this Thursday, the 14th.
And
to demand that
go ahead. No, go ahead. Tell us.
Yeah, it's to demand that the state appointed board recognize their bargaining rights because they voted to no longer recognize the union as of October 31st.
Wow.
And also return the school board to local control because for the last 5 years it's been controlled by a state-appointed board. I'm calling from Central Arkansas DSA. We're raising money for the kids who rely on the schools for lunches and for breakfast and lunches.
Oh, good for
and
you
I want to ask, people to go to centralarkansasdsa.org, click on the button that says Bread for Ed, and donate. I don't know, 5, 10, 20, anything you have. It really would really help. And it would really help the teachers to know that the community is behind them because it's going to be a very difficult fight.
All right. We're going to put this link in the on the YouTube show and on the podcast description, and we'll put it on the front page of majority.fm, and we'll try and tweet it out. Tweet at us with this link, will you, please?
Yes, we will.
And we'll put that out there. Keep us updated.
Yeah, thank you so much.
And if anybody donates after listening to this, tweet it out and tag the show.
Indeed.
Appreciate the call.
Thanks for what you're doing, man.
Thank you. Right, bye.
Call from a 210 area code. Folks, bear with us. We get a lot of callers on the line. Been on for a long time.
Good afternoon, Sam. It's John from San Antonio.
John from San Antonio. How are you, sir?
I'm good. Yeah, it was a great weekend for Bernie Sanders' campaign. They held a climate crisis summit in Des Moines, Iowa, featuring great advocates for the Green New Deal like Naomi Klein, Molly Crabapple, and Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez.
Naomi Klein, I think this is the first time she's ever endorsed a presidential candidate. She endorsed Bernie Sanders.
Friend of the show.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah, so AOC appeared at three events on Saturday that drew the largest crowds of any of Bernie's events this year in Iowa. So here's a tweet that I put out on Saturday. Absolutely love AOC's comments on voter participation. Here's her quote. This is not something we watch. We don't watch the polls. We change the polls. We don't watch the presidential race. This is not a movie. This is a movement. And I can't wait for the 2028 run for the presidency.
This is not being bad. This is not being bad.
So one of the most frustrating events happening recently is that the newly elected Democratic senators have been extremely conservative. Kristen Sinema, Jackie Rosen were examples of this from the Democrats that flipped the Senate seats in 2018. Unfortunately, the polling leaders in the primaries for the Democratic Senate races are also very conservative. I'm talking about John Hickenlooper in Colorado, Mark Kelly in Arizona, yep. Democratic Senatorial Campaign Committee endorsed Cal Cunningham in North Carolina, MJ Hagar in Texas, Amy McGrath in Kentucky, Barbara Bollier in Kansas, and Teresa Greenfield in Iowa, and also Ossoff in Georgia. And all of those are all endorsed by the DSCC, except for Ossoff. I haven't seen that yet. But just a little bit alarming, just because they are so conservative. Jeff Sessions decided to run for his old Senate seat, and he has a 13-point lead over former Auburn University football coach Tommy Tuberville, who previously had a double-digit lead over the field. The question is, will Sessions be humiliated by Trump and lose the support of Alabama voters? Sessions put out a bootlicking video that's totally pathetic. So if Sessions at Tuberville or any sitting House member of Bradley Byrne win the nomination, there will be a heavy favorite to beat Doug Jones, who only won because Alabama Republicans nominated Roy Moore, who had so many incidents of inappropriate behavior towards underage women. So the Alabama primary is on Super Tuesday. So if Jones loses, the magic number will be four seats to win the president's to win the Senate if the Democrats win the presidency. So yeah, in Colorado, Democratic frontrunner John Hickenlooper, there's just a report that came out about detailing questionable gifts and travel accommodations on corporate jets. So Hickenlooper is accused of violating Colorado Constitution's
ban. Why not go with that guy? Right?
Why not endorse him, right?
It's not like you're trying to run a national campaign literally on the corruption that the Trump administration represents.
But to be fair, Hickenlooper is super charismatic.
The national campaign, to the extent that these races are nationalized, it's going to be Donald Trump's corruption, right? I mean, it's going to be on the impeachment. And that's what, you know, Cory Gardner is so worried about taking that vote. And the last thing that you want is that Republican candidate to go, you're dinging me for voting to not impeach a corrupt guy, dude, look at you. I mean, this is so rudimentary. Yet the Chuck Schumer has jumped right in with both feet promoting Hickenlooper, and the rest of them have. It's unbelievable. And look, this is going to be the reality of, regardless who is president, this is going to be the reality that we're going to have. We're going to have 5 or 6 votes, maybe more. They're all going to be racing to be that, you know, there's going to be a gang of 7, and they're going to find, you know, they're going to find, like, there's going to be a gang of 8, and it's going to be 6 Democrats and 2 Republicans, or it's going to be a gang of 9, and it's going to be 8 Democrats and 1 Republican who are going to stand in the way of any type of legislation. This is a reality. And I don't know. You know, some of these states are also just sort of, it's going to take a while until they trend bluer. You know, like a state like Virginia, for instance, eventually we're going to get a progressive champion there, as opposed to like a Mark Warner, who is sort of a 1993 Democrat. And we're going to see some states that are going to get more progressives, but we're also, when you start going into these sort of reddish purple states, we're going to have conservative senators. I mean, that's what's happening there. And
is that then? I mean, not in Virginia, but it seems to me that, you know, the goal is a John Tester, not a Sinema. If you're going to have more right,
Tester is like increasingly problematic.
Right. No, but relative. I mean, or you know what? Maybe Sherrod Brown.
Well, Sherrod Brown's a completely different.
No, I mean he's complete. No, I mean he's proof that you can be solid labor progressive in a state like Ohio. And that's the problem, is that these places like Virginia makes sense why you'd have like corporate oriented conservative Democrats, because the Virginia suburbs are that. Like,
you look
a major
at like Sherrod
part.
Brown, and he's, you know, been a little bit dubious on Medicare for All, and
absolutely.
And part of that is a function of Ohio moving to the right.
Right.
And I suspect, you know, these are the pressures that they're under. It's not even necessarily the policies in that moment, as much as it is like sort of like the broad meta narrative that people paint. And some of these things end up being cues for those meta narratives. I have very little doubt that Sherrod Brown, when he's, you know, not in public, is like, yeah, we need Medicare for All. And maybe he's positioning himself in such a way that if the vote was to ever happen, he was the 51st vote, he would vote that way. But it, you know, in his mind right now, it's unlikely it's ever going to get to 51 votes. So who knows?
Just for the record, when I talked to the Trillbillies guys this weekend, they don't think that impeachment had anything to do with a Democrat winning the governorship in Kentucky, because Republicans won all down the ballot besides that. They said the most analogous situation was Doug Jones versus Roy Moore, just like a ridiculously unpopular incumbent running against a kind of a scion of the Democratic Party.
Well, impeachment certainly didn't help Bevin.
Sure, but they don't think it had much relationship to this election. They don't think that it mediated it, and they don't think that there are any larger lessons that we can extract from
point. A lot of people were arguing that impeachment's going to hurt the Democrats because it's going to motivate, you know, huge numbers of conservatives coming out. And you had Donald Trump get up with Matt Bevin with the whole people behind him, you know, read the transcript and this is all about me, blah, blah, blah. Donald Trump wasn't on stage with a lot of those other people. And if it hurt Andy Beshear, he must have been, I would be surprised.
Well, turnout was up on both sides, which
That's
is
right.
interesting. So maybe impeachment is kind of a wash.
Well, I mean, you're making an assessment in the reddest of states. And so if the Democrats hadn't impeached, I imagine it would have blunted Democratic turnout. on some level.
Yeah, picture
maybe. A pours a vacuum.
I mean, it's hard to say. I mean, this guy was just like, he was hated by so many people in this state.
No,
he was
I
just
understand.
An asshole. And he was trying to do Trumpism without Trump's charisma, which like, it doesn't work. It really only works for Trump. But it is interesting that Trump could not transfer, because people still like Trump for the most part, like voters in the state overwhelmingly do. And Trump could not transfer that like to Bevin.
That's right. And I think the question is, in these races, will in purple states, right? Will Democrats be able to transfer some of that Trump hate and project it upon these senators?
It seems possible.
It does seem possible.
Hopefully.
Well, go ahead, John.
Yeah, I mean, I just think that you have progressives running against most of these people, and I just think that we should be supporting them. You know, like Andrew Romanoff, we've talked about him in Colorado, Betsy Sweet in Maine, Seema Hernandez. I mean, she was actually second in a poll in Texas, so I'm definitely leaning towards her now. I mean, she's a Bernie supporter. At first, I didn't think she would have much of a chance, but she's doing pretty well. And so there are all kinds of, I mean, Ted Terry, I've talked about him. Also this guy Stephen Cox in Kentucky. I mean, I think McConnell is a lot more vulnerable than people realize. I mean, and so we'll see. You know, he's actually down in some polls, in some recent polls. And so, I mean, as time goes on, the tendency is, you know, he spends a bunch of money and all of a sudden he wins big. I mean, that's what's happened historically. But that may happen again. But, I mean, you know, we've got to give progressives a shot in primaries. And so I just think it's very important for them to run. Another one is Kimberly Graham in Iowa. She also has, I think it's a Justice Democrats endorsement, or maybe it's a brand new Congress. So I think we should really support these candidates.
I think it's like places like Texas and Iowa, sort of like strangely, are the most likely places to get a progressive, where you where there's not as much of an investment by maybe the establishment Democrats, because they think it's a little bit more of a long shot in some respects. But we'll see. Appreciate the call, John, as always.
And all right. Nobody likes Mitch McConnell in Kentucky. It's like his success is partly a function of his immense amounts of money and political skill, but also the Democrats' utter incompetence. And this guy, Matt Jones, who's a radio announcer, might run against him, and I think he really should, because he's got a ton of fans in Kentucky. But God, I hate to keep bringing up Trillbillies, but they told me they have never met a single Mitch McConnell fan living in Kentucky their entire lives.
Well, there's obviously some, because he's won many elections. That does not necessarily mean that they are have the pulse of Kentucky.
I've never met a single Chuck Schumer supporter, and I was talking about my Shoss Boys podcast.
Shoss is supportive of
Schumer. I know. I was just trying to think of something chewy.
Yeah, but when turnout is 25%, like, that doesn't mean everyone in the state loves Mitch.
We were
sucks.
On the Goy. Everybody on the non-Goy Boy podcast doesn't like Chuck Schumer. Everybody said
I went on. I was on with some of my friends who avowed hunters. All hate Chuck Schumer. Don't know a single person who's voted for Chuck Schumer.
Mitch McConnell, not popular in the alt-vegan communist scene in Kentucky. Not popular with the podcasters of Kentucky.
It was a good...
Wow, did you just coastal elite people from Kentucky?
No. There was a great Alex Perrine piece about McConnell, how McConnell does it. That came out a year ago, and
big shipments from shipping containers.
Well, a big part of it that was really interesting was, yeah, I mean, the shipment thing is always interesting, but that his Kentucky record is totally antithetical to his national record. So I mean, maybe it's changed in the last couple of years, but like, oh, like, you know, these union guys, Mitch is showing up to meet them, like, basically a lot of public works projects, a lot of starve the beast for everybody besides Kentucky in geographically significant locations, basically.
Got to get him out. If Matt Jones is listening right now, I encourage you to run. I think you'd be great.
He wasn't going to. And then what's-her-face?
Kate McGrath.
Kate McGrath tried to get him dinged by the FEC for being on television. The Republicans dinged him for being on radio this close to an election that he supposedly was going to be a candidate for. And then this is what I've read. I don't know if it's true. McGrath supposedly folks dinged him for being on TV. He got fired from his TV job. And now he's like, I might as well run because.
Crystal ball says that's the way to go.
He is a little concerned, what with cancel culture and whatnot. Like, he's been tweeting for like 10 years, you know, and there are some things that he said a long time ago that, like, he was kind of a dumb bro jock 10 years ago. Like, he doesn't believe the same things that he believes now. He doesn't believe the same things now that he did then. He would never speak that way. But, like, it is a concern. And his career relies on him being popular with people. So I think that is one thing that he's thinking
about. I think there's a way to handle that.
I would go with, don't worry about somebody's Twitter jokes and worry about an actual person who, in her announcement day, was like, I want to get rid of Mitch McConnell so I can help Donald Trump more.
I mean, I think if you're genuine and you're having the right policies, people will forgive you for things you said 10 years ago.
I think it's the way that you handle it, basically. I think. Call from an 850 area code. You are the final caller of the day. Who's this? Where are you calling from?
This is Cruz from Panama City Beach, Florida.
Cruz, what's on your mind?
I kind of have... The thing is, this area I'm at in the Panhandle is very, very conservative.
Yes, I have friends in Pensacola.
So, the only thing I wonder is how, in an area like that, would you try to best strategy to convince young conservatives, or would you try, because you know, this place only 20% only vote Democrat
right
every election. So would you try to rally up the 20% vote, or would it be like non-voters?
Kowalski Republicans.
Brendan said Kowalski Republicans. I agree.
Yeah, I mean, that could be it too.
There's some places the Democrat label just cannot be rehabilitated.
I mean, frankly, I've also heard stories. Are you like in Matt Gaetz territory?
I think it's District 2 of the Florida, and this place is the one that this county is the one that voted about 70% Republican.
I guess like the idea would be become a Republican and try and do and try and introduce ideas that are in some ways. I guess Matt Gaetz is actually to your west, covering Pensacola, but I can imagine. The only thing I can tell you is I think that, like, you know, it's worth it, I think, to try and build, you know, some type of organization there and talk to young people. I mean, I think that's probably the best that you can do. And then think about, you know, moving to a place where there's like closer to like 55-45 Republican to Democrat and helping out there.
Socialists should absolutely run in Republican primaries in places where Democrats can't win.
Totally.
Yeah.
Well, I'm trying to figure out what to do because as an individual, that's like before I move back to New Mexico. So that's kind of the idea. Also, another thing is that is it logical to for some people to assume from the primary, the candidate more likely to win if they have more individual donors? Because I think, in my opinion, I feel that the amount of individual donors you have is more legitimate than some of the polling data.
I don't
which
think.
Is say,
no, I don't. I mean, I don't think that's the case. I mean, I think, you know, I've told this story. I was up in New Hampshire in 2008 in the Republican primary, And if you looked at how many people were on the streets with Ron Paul signs, you would say that Ron Paul was going to walk away from it, walk away with it, I should say, the election. But it turned out just the relationship between people who would vote for Ron Paul and get on the street in support of Ron Paul was about 1-to-1. And so you can't, I mean, what individual donors tells you is that the ability to stay in the race longer is there, as opposed to somebody who's basically maxed out on high value donors. That's the big tell there. But beyond that, I think you can try and extrapolate, but I don't think it's going to be accurate. Appreciate the call. That is the final call of the day, ladies and gentlemen. We'll take a couple IMs and then get going here. I apologize to the hundreds of people who are hanging on the phone, but we got through as many as we could. We had a lot of people who call in the first, like, second. And so we had, I don't know.
A lot of people wanted to defend Michael Bloomberg.
Yeah, on for 83 minutes or something. Yeah, a lot of Michael Bloomberg stuff. Tim's Kiddie Pool. I recently drove from Connecticut to Florida. The only political billboards, bumper stickers, and yard signs I saw were Tulsi 2020. Should I be concerned?
That's cool.
Jay
Tingle. Very
Tingle.
Fit crew.
Yep. Very, very fit.
Have I OD'd on crazy pills today? Why are so many liberals rending their garments and fretting about ballot irregularities in Bolivia? Also frustrating to look for the word coup in the New York Times or Washington Post. How do I decide which underwear to use anymore? Howard Stern flogs his brand, and now Sam Seder is dropping Trow to plug his label. What, will no one provide an app to let me subscribe to my shorts? Jay Tingle says, as someone who's really getting on in years, I'm switching to adult diapers. And they're definitely subscription-braced, like my toothbrush. Brave-O-Matic, finally Michael Bloomberg's impression is relevant again. Looking forward to hearing it on TYT later this week. Regarding, are you going on TYT this week?
Yes.
And
the damage report.
Are you doing Rogan?
No.
Oh. Regarding the voter roll purge in Georgia, 70,000 who were removed in the last purge in 2017 went on to re-register. A majority, 65%, did so in the same county where they had been removed, meaning they would otherwise have been eligible to vote if not for the state's aggressive purge policy. I mean, there you go. I'm good at sex. You are bad at sex. Not sure if you guys said it already, but Diamond has been chairman of the effing board since 2006. He absolutely has a say in his salary.
And that's so awesome. I don't know. You could have to talk with those guys about it.
Age Oldman. This Fuentes thing is a lot like Shapiro's speech at Stanford. He's trying to say they are the different right. Shapiro seems to think that by stating Nazis are bad, that he gains all the credibility he needs in the aspects of his bizarre fake intellectual arguments. It's shockingly stupid. Nazis are such a Hitler was such an idiot. All right, four more IMs. West Coast comrade, is Jesse Lee Peterson's son Beetlejuice going to be at the debate with Crowder? I don't know that. Oh, I know who that is. Yeah. Champagne communist, solidarity with Bolivia and Evo. 80s guy. Las Vegas recently criminalized homelessness. Pretty disgusting stuff. Oh, Jesus. Connecticut comrade, MR crew, Warren update and question upon your thoughts yesterday. In response to a question from Amy Goodman about changing up the state primary order and referencing issues associated mostly white demographics of Iowa and New Hampshire, Senator Warren became visibly annoyed, stated, I'm just a player in the game. While I think this was a tricky question and this has been the excuse offered up by certain pundits, I think that this same excuse is rarely offered on behalf of Sanders when he stumbles. Castro had a good answer to this. Now, Castro is also not in the running in Iowa, and so it's a little bit more latitude to make this answer. I wouldn't expect anybody to
Bernie's
criticize.
Actually slightly gone a little. I mean, he's acknowledged the craziness of it. Also, pretty.
We can do these clips tomorrow.
Yeah, we'll do. Yeah. But I mean, glass jaw Warren.
Yeah, I mean, I think she could have handled that response better, but not in substance. I think it's just like that question's asked. I mean, it's like on some level, it's a variant of a Chris Klizza question, to be honest with you. Honestly, it is a little bit.
Oh, you comparing like, the godmother, Amy Goodman, to Krystal Izza?
No, I'm comparing
drama.
I'm not comparing her to him at all. But I'm saying that question is like a favorite of the political press.
That'd be cool.
To ask in front of before Iowa as a sort of like, you know, and it's a question that can only be asked to Democrats, right? Because like you can never say that to a Republican going into Iowa because it is completely indicative of the party.
The party's white.
That would be cool though if Amy Goodman was just like, so who do I have? Who are my picks for the Indonesian Communist Party? Like if she did Siliza coverage of
right.
obscure horse leftist
race.
Horse race leftist politics. That would be awesome.
No, I just that question in particular is just one that you hear every year asked of Democrats going in there that is meant to basically get only one response. It's never about reform. You know, if you really want to ask that question about reform, you ask it when there's actually an opportunity for reform. But she could have handled it better, I think. Kentucky Fried Comrade. Hey, I'm our crew. I'm normally a big fan of your analysis, but I need to call you out. Yes, Bloomberg may be unlikable. He may be clueless. He may even be a representation of everything wrong with American politics. But there are several children of DC consultants and strategists who will eat tonight because of Bloomberg's run. That's right. At a very nice restaurant.
Literally quitting job.
Two more. Derek from New Jersey. Thank you for reading my IM last week about Ivanka. Sophomore year, she transferred out and Boris Epstein transferred in. To this day, I have a suspicion they're the same person. I've never seen them in the same room at the same time. And the final IM of the day. Cameo Mooch. Great show, MR. You all reek of confidence. The alpha males are back. See you tomorrow.
It might take all the strength I got to get to where I want, but I know somehow I'm gonna get there. I wasn't looking when I just got caught between the truth and the light bulb. Yeah, I know the clock is ticking, but the meds are gonna kick in, and my pilot light shining bright. I get somewhere the choice was made, for the option where you don't get paid, for the road that bends before it finally breaks you. I guess somehow I lost my drive between the 101 and the 5. Do you know how far the detour takes you? Yeah, I know the clock is ticking, but the meds are gonna kick in, and my pilot light shining bright. I shifted in and out of gear, waiting for my moment to happen. I don't know how much longer I can stay in, or how much more I got to pay to play in. I know somehow the lines got graded somewhere before the credits faded, but my power. Pilot light shining bright.